morning. I too want to thank you for your time and your service to our state and to our country, because being on a jury is one of the most noble and important functions that anything in our government can deal with. Because you are citizens, ordinary, everyday citizens, that are here to decide the fate in a very important case of another ordinary citizen. Before I go any further, my daughters have asked me, and they're right, to apologize for mixing up people's names during the course of this case. It's a serious matter, and I am very sorry for mixing up people's names. The reason my daughters brought it up, I've got three kids, they're all girls, and for all their lives, I've never gotten their names right once. Okay, let me touch on a couple of quick matters. When we picked you all for the jury and we sat down and we talked to you, I mentioned a concern that I had. And some of it kind of came up in the questionnaires, but that seems like in today's society, criminal trials, which have turned into a form of popular entertainment, sometimes talk about justice, and we talked about how there's, you know, justice for Tera. Well, in this case, this is State of New Mexico versus Levi Chavez. The case that's going to talk about justice for Tera, you've learned about, you've heard about throughout this trial. That is the case entitled Estate of Tera Chavez versus Levi Chavez. That case is on hold, as you have heard. So that's where you're going to, that jury is going to be concerned about justice for Tera. I don't want you at all to get the slightest impression that I am thinking that the loss of the life of this young mother of two kids is not very, very important and should not be given the utmost importance by you, because it should. But what a criminal case is about whether or not the state can prove what they allege beyond a reasonable doubt. And so what a criminal case is about, if we're talking about a search for truth, because that's often happened too. And you know, I didn't really get the DA's thing during jury selection where there was a puzzle pieces and then you take them off one at a time and at the end there's the word truth. It'll probably be explained better than it was in jury selection, but I don't get it. Are they saying that Levi was covering up the truth and then we pull it off and then there's the truth? I don't know. Anyway, in a search for truth, the only truth in a criminal case that you're searching for is, are the allegations against him true or are they not? And the reason I'm saying that, and we talked about this during jury selection, is that sometimes you don't get to find out everything that you want to know during the course of a criminal case. A criminal case is not an investigation where if you're unable to decide exactly what happened, then you've done a bad job. No, a criminal case is not an investigation where you have to find everything out. The only thing you have to find out is, can they prove their case or can they not? Now, we talked a lot during jury selection about burden of proof and that the state has to prove guilt beyond a reasonable doubt, okay? And so you look at the state's evidence, and these are sort of gradations that I've come up with of, you know, I believe him not guilty, or it's highly unlikely that he's guilty, or, well, less than likely that he's guilty, probably didn't do it, unlikely, possibly not guilty, may not be guilty, perhaps not guilty. I suspect him. None of those are proof beyond a reasonable doubt.
possibly guilty, probably guilty, likely guilty. Even strong, firm belief in guilt is not guilt if you have to stop and say to yourself, well, wait a minute, what if it was suicide? Because if you have to stop and ask yourself, wait a minute, what if it was suicide? That means you have a doubt. And that means you have a reasonable doubt. And that means that the state has to go beyond that, even if it's a strong, firm belief in guilt. And why is the state's burden so high? We talked about that. We talked about the founding fathers. We talked about the concept that I believe all of you on the jury accepted, that the burden of proof has to be high so that guilty people don't get punished. Because we could catch the 10 guilty guys and make sure they're all convicted. Remember the concept of it's better to let 10 guilty people go free than to imprison an innocent man? So, if we set the burden of proof real low, somewhere in here, like probably, you know, then we'd get all the 10 guilty guys, but we'd get the innocent guy too, and he'd have to do time. And if we make it so high, like we have made in this country for over 200 years, that is to ensure that if there's an innocent man, he doesn't get punished. And that if it's too high so that the state can't quite prove somebody that's guilty, well then so be it, but we don't want to punish the guilty man. That's why the high burden of proof exists. Because you know what? In a civil case, like the one that the Cordovas have brought against Levi, they can, right here, probably. If that's 51% he did it and 49% he didn't, Levi loses. That's how a civil case works. And the burden of proof is even lower for other things. There are standards called clear and convincing evidence, substantial evidence, whatever, depending on what kind of a case it is. For example, if you want to terminate a mother's rights to her child, you don't even have to show probably. It's down here somewhere. But the law for over 200 years has said this is what it's going to take before we're going to condemn a man for murder one. That's what it's going to take. And I'm here to talk to you about it. And I'm here to talk to you about everything that Mr. McKay said. Everything. This is an investigation, as you know, because you've listened through all of this, that started on about October 23rd or 24th. Because you'll remember that Aaron Jones saw no red flags when he was there that first night. Not until after he went and talked to Joseph Cordova. And we will talk about the combustion that occurred when the two of those got together and how it continued to roll. We'll talk about that a little bit later. But this case, as you know, because you've heard witnesses and you've heard the various lawyers say, well, you remember you gave this statement back in February of 07? Or you remember, October of 07? Or do you remember you gave this statement in May of 08? Or do you remember that you examined this thing in 09? And it went on and on and on. Some of the witnesses, like Art Ortiz, that the state hired, did his report, I think, in May. And remember, we started picking you in June. So that means that Levi has been investigated in 2007, 2008, 2009, 2010, 2011, 2012, 2013. A nonstop investigation of Levi Chavez, nonstop television reports with packs of lies that we're going to talk about, that even during jury selection, the DA's office admitted a lot of those were lies. They've backed off some of them, others they haven't. But I'm going to show you their lies. Now, he was investigated for all that time. It took 4 years, 4 years of solid investigation before they even brought charges against him.
And then it's been 2 years now, today, since they brought charges against him. And this case was investigated by the Valencia County Sheriff's Department, the New Mexico State Police, the New Mexico Insurance Fraud Bureau, the Albuquerque Police Department Internal Affairs, the FBI, the civil lawyer and his law firm hired by the Cordovas, and investigators retained by the district attorney's office. So in 7 calendar years, you are seeing 7 different law enforcement agencies. What you just heard Mr. McKay say is what they've come up with. And they have been able to cobble together a semi-believable made-up story. You know, it's very important that you consider these instructions. The law presumes the defendant to be innocent unless or until you are satisfied beyond a reasonable doubt of his guilt. That means that the state has to eradicate any guilt, that any doubt at all about his guilt, that is reasonable. And obviously, you folks aren't going to stop and say, wait, what if it was committed by his evil twin from Mars? No, you're not going to do that, because that would be unreasonable. So if you have to say, wait a minute, then that means that we're basing it on reason and common sense. And we too, just like the state, want you to use all of your reason and common sense. The burden is always on the state to prove guilt beyond a reasonable doubt. It is not required that the state prove guilt beyond all possible doubt. Okay, and of course I agree with that statement. The state doesn't have to prove beyond what is possible. The state doesn't have to prove guilt beyond infinity. The state is not required to prove guilt beyond all possible doubt. No, not beyond infinity. But the test is one of reasonable doubt, and a reasonable doubt is the kind of doubt based on reason and common sense, the kind of doubt that would make a reasonable person hesitate to act in the graver and more important affairs of life. So unless you're willing to just go in there and say, yep, I accept it, lock, stock, and barrel, then that means you have to stop and hesitate and say, wait. And that's what we want you to do. We want you to review the evidence thoroughly and carefully. If you want to go through all of this stuff, we encourage you to go through all of it, every bit of it. Because the more you look at it and the deeper you dig, the more you're going to see that it supports Levi's story. And the more you're going to say, where's the proof beyond the reasonable doubt? I have to tell you that Levi Chavez, when he got charged, he said, you know, I don't have to cooperate in this investigation. That's what he could have said. And when he was charged, he said, you know what, I don't have to say anything. I don't have to do anything. The state has the burden. I can just sit back and make them prove it. Well, what Levi said is that I am going to take this to trial, and I am going to make them prove it, because I'm an innocent man. And so, in addition to making them prove it, I'm going to present my own defense to defend myself against these allegations, because I'm an innocent man. And I'm going to get up on the witness stand, and I'm going to testify so that the jury can see that I am willing to answer any questions that the prosecution wants to ask me, and I'm willing to let the jury size me up and see what they think of me, and I'm willing to tell, and I'm eager to tell that jury what happened. And so he did. Now, I first want to talk about some of the witnesses. We'll get that out of the way, and then we'll go more deeply into the case. But you have to stop, and you have to hesitate, and you have to go slow, and you have to proceed with caution so that you can arrive at the proper verdict, so that you don't wait until a month from now while you're tossing and turning in bed and saying, uh-oh, what if he was innocent? What if it was suicide? No, now's the time to do it. When you go and return for the first time to deliberate, but return to the jury room. Okay, witnesses. Now, this isn't going to necessarily be in any kind of a linear order, but I want you to go with me through this. I think I'd like to start talking about some of the lay witnesses first, meaning non-cop, non-expert. A couple of Tara's best friends, Melanie Gonzalez and Andrea Lucero. Both of them told you they talked to Tara and texted Tara 2-3 times a day, up to several times a day. They knew what was going on with her. They would see her in person nearly every day. Now, I want to be very tactful when I say that when you look at the phone records, you're going to see that Tara wasn't in contact with her parents. The last time she was in contact with her parents was several days before her death. When she's on the phone nonstop making hundreds and hundreds of phone calls, people she doesn't call are her family. And you're going to see that in the records. And you're going to ask yourself, does the family really know what was going on in her life? Remember, no members of the family ever read the text she sent. No members of the family, got up here and told you, no members of the family had ever read her diary until after she was dead. But let's talk about Melanie Gonzalez and Andrea Lucero. So Melanie says that Tara was sad, lonely. She said, this hurts. She was really down. Those were all things she said from the witness stand. She also said that Levi never knew about Tara's affair. Okay, so that's the first one of the state's witnesses who goes contrary to one of the state's. You know, the state has to have five different theories and let you kind of pick from them like a smorgasbord, I guess, of why Levi would kill the mother of his children. But Melanie Gonzalez tells you that Tara was sad, lonely, hurt, and really down, that Levi never knew about the affairs, and, interestingly, Melanie Gonzalez was told about the car theft by Tara, but Melanie Gonzalez was never told that it was supposedly a fake car theft. No, Rose Lama's the only one of those that came up here to tell you that. Other thing about Melanie Gonzalez was she pointed out that both Nick and Samantha Wheeler were pumping her for information about the case. What do the police know? What do the police have? Calling her at all kinds of odd hours of the night, calling them nonstop, bugging them for information about the case, to the point where Melanie Gonzalez finally had to cut the Wheelers off because they were bugging her so much, she was so offended that they would care so much about what the police had instead of, you know, the issue at hand like a dead friend. The reason I mention that is not because I want you to conclude that Nick and or Samantha Wheeler killed Tara, but I want to contrast the involvement of Nick Wheeler in this case to the involvement of Levi in this case. And then the unbelievable scorched earth investigation of Levi Chavez compared to zip for Nick Wheeler. Because that tells you that this was not an objective police investigation. Levi was targeted from the very night that Aaron Jones and Joseph Cordova met and talked. And he was the one and only target, to the exclusion of evidence to the contrary, to the exclusion of evidence of suicide, to the exclusion of even investigating somebody else who had more involvement. So we're going to get into Nick and Samantha later. Andrea Lucero, she told you that Tara kept things bottled up, and we know that. She told you that Tara was not afraid of Levi. She told you that weekend that Levi was out of town and Tara was reaching the zenith of her suicidal pain, said that weekend, Tara and she went to get groceries and went to rent movies because Tara was expecting a weekend with Levi. Or she told Andrea she was expecting a weekend with Levi. They were going to hang out, according to Andrea Lucero, that weekend. They were, and you heard it from the witness stand, they were going to get together and try and work on her marriage. Or so poor Tara thought. Also, Andrea told you that Tara was hurt, very hurt, as it became apparent to her right at the end, and we'll show you how close to the end, because Nick Wheeler was the last person to talk to Tara. She was hurt that her affair with Nick was not going to blossom, and it only increased geometrically. It became so much that she had to get rid of the pain, and we're going to talk about Dr. Berman. Another funny thing is, Andrea said that, she knew from Tara about the truck being stolen, but she was never ever told about a supposed fake theft. Now, that's only Rose Lama. Remember, Andrea, one of her very best friends that talked to her several times a day. When Aaron Jones asked Andrea, you'll remember this testimony, can you think of anyone who might possibly want to kill Tara? Andrea, Tara's best friend, said, Samantha Wheeler, without dropping a beat. Didn't say Levi. After Tara died, Levi begged her, please tell me. If Tara was having an affair. There's, now that she's died, there's this investigation, and it's come up, and I've heard that Tara was having an affair. Please tell me. I don't want to have to hear it from some cop I don't even know. If you know, I'm begging you. And eventually, Andrea told you she told it. And he said, actually Andrea's recollection was, he said, thank you saved my ass. I corrected her and said, didn't you say earlier, he said, thank you saved my life. Levi recalled it as something like, I'll be wondering about it for the rest of my life. But you know what, thank you saved my life. What is so weird about that? I think I just heard Mr. McKay say that was very strange. If you're Levi and you've already had to go through the shock and horror, the life-changing experience, making fun of him that he's not going to be a changed man after he walks in and finds his wife dead because of his philandering ways, that's not a life-changing experience, that's something to snicker about. No, it's not. So, thank you, you saved my life. Yeah, because otherwise he would be tortured for the rest of his life wondering, A, did Tara really have an affair, and B, who was it with? Now, is Levi a little bit self-centered? Wondering about Tara's affairs when you know what kind of sleep-around guy he was? You may conclude that. He's not on trial for being self-centered. If he were, would just plead guilty. But that's what was in his heart, and that's what was going on. And he was particularly vulnerable because he had gone through a horror that, God forbid, none of us ever have to go through. And on the heels of that, he learns about his wife, and he is in this vulnerable place. You get the picture. You know what Levi is. Levi is a shy, kind of reserved guy, occasionally cocky a little bit, usually pretty funny and fun to be with. People enjoy his company, but he just was in that place where learning about his wife was something that he needed to do at that moment. None of us will probably understand how we would behave and how we would react on the heels of that kind of experience that he experienced around 9 p.m. October 21st, 2007. Gina Cordova, she's married to one of the Cordova brothers. She told you. Tara was sometimes happy, sometimes sad. Sometimes their marriage was going good. Sometimes their marriage was going bad. And in particular, I'm going to ask you to recall the testimony of Gina Cordova that Tara's, and I said it, but she agreed with me, that Tara's self-esteem came from being married to Levi. And she was happy to be married to a police officer, and that her identity was tied up in being married to Levi. Being married to a police officer, having a husband, having children, not having to ask the parents for money because she and Levi were doing their damnedest to make it on their own, to show the Cordova family that they could do so. And why did they need to show the Cordova family? We'll get into that later, too. Gina Cordova, even though she is a Cordova, told you that Tara was not afraid of Levi, and she was not afraid of Levi. She went over to Levi's house to ask him what happened. And they went to the back, and they sat down together, and Levi told her what happened. And Levi's story has never changed one bit, not one iota. Levi may be one of the few people in this entire case whose story has never changed, okay? Now, the state wants you to think about, I wasn't sure if it was the aviation police Glock 17 9mm or it was the APD Glock 17 9mm, or that when he came, the night of the thing, he told Jones, yeah, I taught her how to use that effing gun. Well, that effing gun was a Glock 17 9mm. Are you going to be holding a man who just walked in and found his wife dead in the most gruesome of circumstances? Are you going to hold him to precise grammatical phrasing? He meant that gun meaning Glock 17 9mm. Hell, some of you guys in jury selection said, yeah, I shot that gun. Did you mean this gun, or did you mean Glock 17 9mm, that gun? He meant she knew how to shoot a Glock 17 9mm. Is that so hard to accept? Is that very strange, like the prosecution wants you to believe? I want to talk, I guess, next see how are we going to do this. I might want to talk about Aaron Jones next, but I have to put it in the context of what he said to all of these witnesses. But before I do that, let's get into that contrast. Before I get into Jones and who he investigated and who he didn't, let's get into the contrast between Nick and Samantha and Levi. Okay? Levi wrote out consents to search, said, sure, you can search my home. Here, here's my phone. Take it. Download it. Here, here's my computer. Take it. Download it. Here, I'll give you some DNA. No, you don't need to get a search warrant. Here, here's some DNA. There's my fingerprints. He gave statements to Aaron Jones, was read his rights and talked that night, came back again. I believe he came back a third time, but whether it was two or three times, he never lawyered up. He came in and talked to the guy. He said, you know, after, I think about the third visit, after Aaron Jones asked him what happened, he told him what happened. And he never used the word suicide, not once. And we're going to get into some of that about the 911 calls, because if Levi wanted to, was so intent on making this look like a suicide, but it was really a murder, why wouldn't Levi start from the very beginning? Why wouldn't he do like a guilty person would do and start saying on the 911 call, oh, I was with somewhere else with another woman and then she committed suicide and blah, blah, blah. No. He didn't do that. He said, my wife just shot herself in the head. He said she was dead. And he said, send the 34s now. I need them now. Please. Now. Please. Hurry. Send somebody. And he told you that in Albuquerque, when you tell the 911 operator that you got a dead person just shot in the head, that they send everybody, and that when you say 34s, you're getting the fire and rescue, Albuquerque ambulance, the police department, the major crime scene van unit, everything. Because they send out the cavalry when somebody calls up and says somebody just got shot in the head. And that's what Levi was expecting, and you heard the urgency in his voice. And it's crazy, crazy. To say that, okay, well, he's guilty because he didn't perform CPR. You saw the photographs. That's how he found his wife. You saw the torture that he had to go through when he was on the witness stand describing that it was black. And by the way, not red, black. And he said it was like spackling. And he said, come on, you've seen those photographs. I'm a police officer, what? You want me to do CPR on a cold, dead, stiff Tara? He said he couldn't bear to look at her. Remember, he was on his knees, crying and saying, why? But he wouldn't look up at her face. Because part of the torture and part of the horror, probably as big or even bigger, when it's interconnected with finding your wife dead there, is knowing that for years she's been saying, Levi, Levi, I am nothing without you. Levi, don't leave me. I'm going to kill myself. And he never believed it. He thought it was one of her threats, one of her ways to lure him back. And she had many different ways of luring him back. And if you want to read through all of this stuff, because some of it I didn't bring up in trial, but it's in here. You're going to find out about the other ways she tried to tantalize him back. She tried lots of different things. She was a desperate wife. And a lot of her desperation did have to do with Levi. These people were just a couple that were in love, but were a very, very bad, bad match. And it was very bad and toxic mentally and spiritually. for them, and you all know that from this. But as I was saying, part of the real torture is him knowing that she had sent him these texts, and she had left him voicemails that he didn't even listen to. And we're going to talk, by the way, I can't believe, but maybe I can, now the DA's office is adopting Aaron Jones' argument about that he conveniently only saved one text. Well, we're going to prove that's a lie. That's just one of Aaron Jones' lies, and we're going to prove it to you in a minute here. So, Levi does all of those things without a lawyer. He also, at the scene, says, swab me for gunshot residue. Well, we all learned later from the OMI lady that gunshot residue tests aren't commonly done anymore. But Aaron Jones thought they were, and Aaron Jones made sure that Tara's hands were bagged up with the OMI person, and they went off to OMI because he thought, well, it was a suicide, and this way we'll see if there's gunshot residue here. I'm glad he bagged the hands, because there's no chipped or broken fingernails, there's long fingernails with nothing in them, no sign of resistance whatsoever, and we'll get to that in a minute. But Levi was naively thinking that, yes, it would be over in a week, because he knew he was innocent, and he knew that the facts were the facts, and he was thinking that Aaron Jones, like he told you on the witness stand, at the time he thought Aaron Jones was legit. Now, remember Nick Wheeler testifying? Nick Wheeler is the guy that's the buddy of Aaron Jones. Nick Wheeler's the guy that, believe it or not, I mean, this is mind-blowing, while Aaron Jones is conducting his initial interviews with Levi Chavez, Nick Wheeler's calling him on the phone, calling him on his cell phone because they're buddies and they even got their phones, cell phones programmed into each other's phone. He's calling him on the phone, asking him, you're working on that Tera Chavez investigation. And while Jones is talking to Levi. So, after all of that, and after all the bugging and pumping for information, and Aaron Jones told you how Nick Wheeler and Samantha Wheeler were constantly calling him and pumping him for information nonstop. And Aaron Jones told you, Nick Wheeler's his buddy. Nick Wheeler was even a witness for him on one of the lawsuits or on the witness list. You got pictures of him and Nick Wheeler, Aaron Jones does, in his office, or he did, back when he had an office, before he thought that his computers were being taken over and he had to move to his house. But we'll talk more about that later. So Nick Wheeler, no search done of the house, no phones taken, no downloads of them, no computers taken, no downloads of them, no DNA taken. And that's interesting because there was an unidentified male hair found. And yeah, I think I might have said Levi was excluded. I thought he was excluded. But he could have been excluded because the DNA lady told you that because this hair didn't have enough of a bulb or whatever she called it at the end, they couldn't get enough to do a DNA profile with the type of DNA testing, the polymerase chain reaction amplification, whatever, they couldn't get DNA profile from their lab. But she also told you that she was very aware that there were other labs that tested for mitochondrial DNA. And they just let that hair sit there for 4+ years because they want to convict Levi Chavez. They don't want to test that hair, because then if they test that hair, they're going to have less of a case than they have now. And gosh knows they've done their best to try to cobble together something to come into court with. Okay, so Nick didn't have to turn over his set of fingerprints, of course. he remember this. Levi gave statement after statement after statement, never lawyered up. Nick Wheeler, first statement he gives it with Samantha present. Remember when Aaron Jones talked about the Reed method of police interviewing and police interrogation and agreed with me that, gee, you're supposed to separate the people when you're trying to take statements and you're trying to find out what happened? That's what an investigation is when you're trying to find out what happened. It's not what Aaron Jones did. Aaron Jones wasn't ever trying to find out what happened. Aaron Jones was trying to beat the story of Levi's guilty into everybody he interviewed, and we're going to talk more about that later. But anyhow, the first statement Nick Wheeler gives, husband and wife together. It makes common sense. If you want to know the truth, you know, you want them to get their story straight by being together? No, I mean with anybody. I'm not necessarily talking about the Wheelers now. I'm just talking about what makes common sense to us lay people that would be good investigative thinking. Second statement Aaron Jones gives, takes from Nick Wheeler, happens in a lawyer's office. Nick Wheeler, when Aaron Jones calls him for the second statement, sorry, bud, you know it's going to have to go through the attorney. So Nick Wheeler's lawyered up. But does Nick Wheeler ever get investigated? No. Now, I'm going to see how much time we got before I decide which witness to go into next. Okay. Remember Jeannie Morrow? Jeannie Morrow was the lady that was the flight attendant. Jeannie Morrow was the lady that had been a police officer in Houston, and she saw a bunch of police coming and saw the hubbub, and having been a police officer, she figured, first thought was maybe somebody's dead. And she gets out, I think water and soft drinks or whatever she gets out, she opens her garage door, lays those things out there for the officers, goes and tells the officers, hey guys, you can use my restroom if you want, you can go through the you can go through my garage, and right here outside in my garage, I've got stuff for you to drink if you guys need it. And by the way, when I say talk to the police officers at letting them use the restroom, that's before the Albuquerque Police Department officers showed up. We're talking about when the actual investigators from Valencia County showed up. Okay, so this is Jeannie Morrow. Remember, she and her husband had video cameras, and at the time that the police finally came to talk to her, she had first been talked to by the Cordovas, and then by the time the police finally come and talk to her, her husband has readjusted the video cameras so that they're on the property and don't go onto the street. And remember that they used to be on the street, including back when this all happened. And that because they were motion sensitive, or whatever you call it, they start working when the cameras see movement. Having them point to the street was wasting up a whole lot of recording space, because every time a car would go by, they'd go on. And so the Morrows would rather have it right focused on their property, so it only goes on when somebody goes onto their property. But back then, you heard that she and her husband watched videos for hours and hours and hours during the applicable time period. There was never any seeing of Levi, but remember when, I'm doing this for illustration, remember when she got up on the witness stand and said, yeah, I saw Levi Chavez, and I saw him on Saturday the 20th of October 2007. Wow, that would have been a powerful witness. That would have blown Levi's alibi, a word that he has never used. But That would have blown Levi's alibi, because Levi knows and Deborah Romero knows that they were together on the 20th. So she gets up on the witness stand and she says that. And then I ask her, I say, hey, so you want to look at a calendar? You want to look at your work schedule? You sure about this? And she looks and she looks, and God bless her honesty and her courage. Because from that witness stand, she said, you know something? I have to correct myself. I didn't see him on the 20th. I saw him on the 17th. I saw him on the 17th. They had her in the loop of this cobbled together story for a while, but she broke away right on the witness stand and told you the truth. And the truth that she told you matched what Sergeant Clyde Joseph said. Remember, Clyde Joseph said he went up to this woman and she said, yeah, I saw him on Wednesday. The reason I bring that up, among other things, is to suggest to you that it is unfair for the district attorney's office to sneer at the fact that Levi mixed up his days during his deposition, 2 years after the event, and before any criminal charges had been filed, and before he had any of this stuff to refresh his memory, that he said, no, I wasn't in Las Lunas on Friday. And he told you, I meant later on when he got all of this stuff, and he got all of these records, and he was able to put things in context, realized that, yeah, I was in Las Lunas on Saturday, or I was in Las Lunas on Friday. And before he said that he wasn't in Las Lunas on Friday because he was thinking of Saturday. And he said he didn't have a calendar. And Mr. McKay would chortle that, oh, he doesn't have a calendar, that's his excuse. Well, what about Jeannie Morrow, your own witness, man, who got up on direct examination and said what you wanted her to say until she got a calendar? And let's talk about Sergeant Clyde Joseph. Sergeant Clyde Joseph was one solid man. You remember him. He was kind of like been there for a good long time, sergeant for the Valencia County Police Department. He wasn't a young buck trying to make names, trying to create sensations, trying to make a really big hullabaloo whoop-de-doo case. No, he's just a good, honest cop. And he said that when Levi got there, Levi never mentioned suicide, never said, because Aaron Jones, remember Aaron Jones was telling every one of these witnesses, there's something wrong with that Levi. All he says is suicide, suicide, suicide. Pretty funny, never used the word once, but Levi didn't mention the word suicide with Clyde Joseph, not once. He didn't one time say he was a cop, and he didn't come home in cop outfit either. He came home in jeans and a sweater because that's what he wore from Deborah Romero's house. Didn't say he was a cop. DA's office wants you to believe a thin blue line. Oh, corruption, culture of corruption of the police. Sergeant Clyde Joseph gets there. What does he do? He sees Levi looking distraught, crying on his knees, saying why. Sergeant Clyde Joseph tells you that Levi never saw him, didn't notice him for the longest time. Sergeant Joseph was standing in the doorway just looking at Levi. Levi isn't even aware of his presence. Clyde Joseph tells you that under the circumstances, meaning the circumstances of walking in on a dead wife, was there anything unusual or inappropriate about the scene or about Levi Chavez? No. And then, this is the nugget I want you to take with you, because once again, it shows the fallacy of the state. The state is trying to have you sneer, like it sneers, about Levi's contention that he turned the lights on. Oh, he walked in the house. In none of these statements where he talked to police did he ever say he turned the light on. Well, what? That's supposed to be some big deal? I don't know. We didn't know it was a big deal. We didn't know it was a big deal until Aaron Jones comes in with his manufactured stuff, and we're going to get to that. But what does Clyde Joseph say? And I sure hope you took notes, at least some of you, about this. Because I asked a very non-leading question. In fact, I didn't even ask him. I didn't even bring up lights. I said, and I hope you remember this question. This is the question I posed to Sergeant Clyde Joseph. I said, well, were you able to see blood on Tera in the dark in that room? And his answer was strong and clear. The lights were on when I first walked into that room. The lights were on when I first walked into that room. Clyde Joseph, the first cop there. So, stop your chortling, State. Now, Virginia Bateman from the FBI. What she told you was that these were really old phones, that they didn't have a lot of the sophistication, and part of the lack of sophistication means that a lot of the stuff she was trying to pull off of them were in an unsupported format or something like that. I don't remember her exact words. But basically, she told you that with the phone that Levi turned over to the police voluntarily, and the other two phones that Joseph Cordova got from, I don't know if he snatched them or what, we didn't hear anything about asking permission, but that he took from Levi's two children, those phones, he got them and turned them over to Aaron Jones, and those were all downloaded. Virginia Bateman told you that with regard to each phone, she had to use three different software programs. One of them was called Cellbrite, and I think one of them was called RZT or something, and another one was called something else, but that she used three different programs, and that some of them would get some of the information, able to capture it, and some of them would get some, but none of the programs got everything, and that there was a lot lost. And both she and the computer guy told you that, when something is deleted, it goes into unallocated space, and so it's not really deleted, it's not gone, but it doesn't have an arrow pointing to exactly where it is, it's just, floating in there somewhere. Well, she told you that we use these programs to try to extract this information, but we can't always get everything. And sometimes we can get a little bit, but on this program, well, maybe we can't get text messages. On this other program, maybe we can get incoming but not outgoing or whatever. This program, we can get videos and photographs, but we can't get texts. And so, they got what they got. And she told you, and it was real clear, and I hope you all took notes on this too, that she was never, ever trying to assert that her three methods, even combined, were all-encompassing and able to pull everything off the phones. And so what you got, you got. But I'm going to show you, and I'm going to tell you something, and it may have to wait until after lunch, probably will. I'm going to show you that they got more texts than the DA wants you to believe in their little thinking inside the box PowerPoint presentation. There's more. I don't have a PowerPoint, but I'm outside the box, and we're going to talk about the stuff outside the box. Bateman also told you that these phones were old and that there was no spyware. Because you see, the state, in all the years since 2007, has been scrambling to try to find a way to prove an innocent man guilty. And back in time, their theory was, Levi Chavez installed some kind of secret stuff on the phones so that he could send messages and make it look like it was coming from Tara's phone. That was the theory. You didn't hear it in here because they abandoned that theory before we went to court. But there were a lot of theories that you heard here that they even abandoned during the middle of trial, and we'll talk about those too. But anyhow, that's why we got Virginia Bateman to say that there was no spyware, because we had to defend against that. Because Levi and I didn't know what kind of moving target we had to deal with the DA's office and the investigators changing motives left and right, changing means and manners of committing this thing left and right. We had to be prepared to deal with all of it. Now, what lawyers tell you isn't evidence, but I'll tell you that both sides had more than 20,000 pages of documents and materials and things that don't even include videos and photographs and all that kind of stuff. That's what 7 or 6 or however many years of investigation will produce. Tens of thousands of pages with innumerable different wild theories. So, no spyware or cloneware. We didn't end up having to be important, but just in case that came back into the DA's pantheon of made up motives and made up means and methods, it was there for you. The computer guy. The DA has this big, bold letters that thousands of files were deleted. Well, you know, I don't know that much about computers. I know that they say that if your computer's running slow for a troubleshooting thing, you might try deleting all your temporary internet files, or you might try deleting these things on your desktop. Sometimes there's these programs that just keep running and running in the background, even though you're not using them. Well, delete them. And by the way, all this deleted stuff, as though it were nefarious, Brookerson also told you about all these deleted photographs of women's shoes. Whatever, catalog for children's clothing. Looking up astrological sites. We know Tara had a book of astrology under her bed the night she died. Astrology. All kinds of innocuous stuff. So now, if the state had come in here and was able to show you that Levi or someone with laser-like precision was able to delete only the stuff that would implicate him in a crime, then maybe that would mean something. But when you hit a damn button and everything gets deleted because you want to get your computer working better, and you end up deleting stuff that the state wants to put, you know, evil touches on, but then also deleted is all kinds of, you know, ads for women's pumps at Sears or something, you know, that dog don't hunt. I want to talk very briefly, because I know it's about, the judge is about to stop me. Are you about to stop me?
Oh, why don't we stop her?
Okay, we'll stop now.
Be back at 1:15 and we'll get started between 1:15 and 1:30.
All right.
Maybe see that.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
So we were talking, I think, before we quit, about the computer guy, how to kill somebody, you know, He looks at it for less than 30 seconds. You saw it because we pulled it up to show you. It was some dumb little thing, like sort of like a parody thing. It didn't have anything on it. And Levi told you about his interest, lifelong interest in wrestling and boxing and martial arts and this and that. And so now Mr. McKay says, oh, that must be a lie, because in all of our assembling of every sin that Levi ever committed since he was 16 years old, we didn't find any evidence of him being involved in martial arts. I'm just going to want to ask you now, and I don't have something to flash on there for you. I don't know if you still have your notes, do you? Okay. Look at State's Exhibit Number 107, because at the bottom of the floorboard of that armoire are a bunch of red boxing wraps, boxer's wraps, that you wrap your hands with before you put the gloves on, because somebody's looking out for Levi, and yeah, we have proof that he was involved in martial arts. Anyway, computer guy. How to kill somebody less than 30 seconds. Also look how to lift, you know, what, rip a throat out, something like that. Dumb, immature. But what a lame theory that Levi has been premeditating for 1 year, because remember, this occurred 1 year before Tara died, that he was plotting to kill Tara for 1 year because one of the girlfriends out of the many he had kicked him out, and Tara found out about it, and Tara got mad. So how's that any different from any of the other women? I mean, really, let's be honest here. And let's look at how far the bottom of the dregs of the barrel the state has to scrape to try to come up with some, no proof you're in martial arts. Oh, you must have been plotting for a year because one of your girlfriends kicked you out and Tara got mad about it, or something like that. Anyway, that was that guy. Real quick, let me go to the 911 operator, the Valencia County Custodian of Records for 911, and then the APD Custodian of Records for 911. And I guess a lot of people don't know why I called the APD person. And a lot of people have come up to me and have said, like, what was that evidence? What was that about? Well, here's the deal. Levi called 911, and you heard his voice. And by the way, to find him guilty, you have to believe that he is a liar and a phony when he was making the 911 call. But if he were a liar and a phony before making the 911 call, then it wouldn't make sense, would it, that he's crying and screaming and saying, oh my God, Tara, oh my God, Tara, how could you do this, before the phone even connects with Valencia County. They have a system that starts recording the call before it even connects to the police department. And you hear Levi Chavez moaning in agony and torture over finding the death of his wife that he believes he personally has caused by being a bad husband and by ignoring her when she was crying out in her moment of need. And he feels, in his words, like God is saying, it's all your fault. And it's seconds after that, when he's down on his knees up against the bed like this, crying, that right near there's the landline, and he picks up the landline. And he is going through what he's going through before the police department ever picks it up. Now, why did I call the APD guy? Because I didn't want the state to get up and argue, oh, he's a police officer, of course he would know that. That's part of his evil genius plan, the brilliant criminal sophisticat that he is. However, I called the APD guy, counterpart from APD, communications man, and he says, hell no, or heck, he didn't say that. He said, we don't have that system. We it only picks up And this is from Anthony Simos, who has worked with the ABD Communications Division. He's now the director, but he's worked with him, he told you, for 20 years. And he told you he'd never even heard of a system that started recording before the phone picked up. So that's just to dampen any more accusations that Levi was really a super slick plotter. Levi simply was a broken man that night. Okay. I'd like to talk right now about Aaron Jones. Aaron Jones, I guess it would be fair to say that Aaron Jones is the only one that sat in that witness box during this entire trial from the very beginning to the very end, the only witness that was literally out of control in the courtroom. I say literally because he's the only witness that the judge had to threaten with holding in contempt of court. Do you remember any other witness other than Aaron Jones that the judge had to threaten with contempt? He's the only witness that when he was testifying and you got sent out and you came back, the judge told you to disregard his comments. Any other witness in this trial, did the judge tell you to disregard their comments? Nope, just Aaron Jones. Now, I said Aaron Jones was a liar in my opening statement, and now that we've had a trial, I'm going to show you all the ways he was a liar. First of all, let's focus on how he treated these witnesses. He agreed with me, and again, we're talking about the way police are taught, and he agreed with me that virtually every law enforcement agency in the country teaches police on some variant of the Reed method. And he told you that, among other things, the Reed method says that when you're conducting your initial interviews of witnesses, you ask open-ended questions. Because if you're really a legit investigator, you're wanting to find out what happened. And so you ask open-ended questions. Remember me asking Jones and saying, and then you just take your inquiry where the responses lead you. Yes, I would agree with that, he said. And then he had a real hard time explaining why he did the opposite. Remember every time I would ask him over and over again, oh yeah, and how does that advance the search for truth? And how does that advance for the search for truth? Well, I can't tell you, but that's what I chose to do. Oh yeah, well how does that help emphasize how important these charges are? How's that even an investigation? Well, I don't know, but I asked you that. Yes, I did. He used deception, but you see, and police are allowed to use deception. I'm not saying they're not. But usually when police use deception, they're using deception on a suspect to try to solve crime. They have a suspect in there and they say, well, you know what? Your partner in crime just pointed the finger at you. Now what are you gonna do to try to provoke he did that, well, he's the one that did it, whatever. You know, you've seen that all in the movies. They use deception and that's fine. Or sometimes they lie and say, you know, we got a really strong case against you. Go a lot easier for you if you fess up now, because you know, we found your fingerprints on it. And they didn't, but they're like, oh, okay, I fess up. That's how police usually, in a legitimate way, use deception. To solve a crime by seeing if they can lure the suspect out into saying something. But no, that's not what Aaron Jones did. Aaron Jones lied to instill in each of the witnesses, mostly these female witnesses, and I'm not just talking about the paramours or mistresses. I'm talking about you. Well, you saw it, you heard it, you remember it, and you took notes about it. He was trying to inspire horrible fear of Levi Chavez. He was trying to instill suspicion. He was trying to instill hatred toward Levi Chavez. He was trying to demonize every witness before he even got to the questions, or sometimes after he got questions and then after his questions got answers he didn't like, then, like Deborah Romero, then he really started tunneling down. But he wanted to first convince everybody that Levi was guilty, and that's how his investigation went. And he wasn't an investigator, and that's why in my opening statement I said he was more like an agent of propaganda than an investigator. And let's look into exactly how that happened, so it's not just my words. It's connecting up with this evidence. He also tried to convince everybody that Levi was a brilliant, evil genius, that Levi was an Academy Award-winning actor, and then he even told you that he personally believes Levi is a brilliant criminal mastermind genius, and that Levi is a brilliant Academy Award caliber actor. You saw Levi, you had a chance. I don't know if there was snot, I don't know if you believe him not, but you got to size him up, man, and that's what he wanted you to do, because that's what an innocent man would do, would give everything and say, yeah, you know what, I am gonna make you prove me guilty, but I'm gonna go a step further. I'm gonna give you everything I've got. You want my phone, you want my computer, you want my DNA, you want me to come in and give 3, 4, 5 statements? You want me to do all of that without a lawyer? You want me to get up on the witness stand and testify so that the prosecutor could have at me everything he wants to ask me, and I'm gonna tell the jury what I know. Is that what a guilty man does? Okay, so these are some of Aaron Jones' lies. APD was a conspiracy of corruption. Corruption, corruption. Remember that even rubbed off on Deborah Romero a little bit. Oh, but the corruption. Levi Chavez got brand new insurance policy he never had. He told witness after witness that. Both sides have agreed the insurance policy's never changed. It's one of those exhibits you have. He got a brand new insurance policy he never had. Now, is that an investigator telling things that are lies to witnesses to try to get them to say what he wants them to say? The truck wasn't really stolen. Well, you have an exhibit here. Excuse me, you have a jury instruction. One of them, it's jury instruction number 11. Mr. Farrelly conducted an investigation into possible insurance fraud as a result of the phone call. The investigation concluded that the allegations were unfounded. You must accept these facts as true. Unfounded. Not that they just didn't bring charges. Not that they had some evidence and were pretty sure he did it, but not quite enough evidence. No. Unfounded. Unfounded means lacking any foundation or basis in fact. It means baseless. It means groundless. Okay? But Levi Chavez, according to Jones, was involved in all kinds of nefarious activities, and we'll get a little bit more into that because that's the hallmark of Aaron Jones. Okay, handwriting. That's not Tara's handwriting. No, sir, that's not Tara's handwriting. I asked him on the witness stand, are you aware that that was Tara's handwriting? And that the state's own expert, that the state spent taxpayer dollars on, and I'm glad they did. Our tax dollars at work. Turns out Levi didn't do it, nobody else did it. Tara wrote those suicide notes, and they are suicide notes. How the state can tell you with a straight face that they're not suicide notes is beyond me. But we're gonna get to that in a minute. Remember, he's telling these women, particularly Deborah Romero, because she's a police officer, but also Rose Slama and everybody else, takes them and shows them the most gruesome of crime photos. I wonder how insensitive is that? How insensitive is that to the Cordova family? How insensitive is that to the witnesses? How twisted is that for an investigator when he's trying to find out, gee, do you know, is this a suicide or is this not a suicide? That's my assignment. So I'll go tell everybody that he's a bad killer, that he's evil, that everything he does is evil. And then I'll ask him, do you think it was a murder or do you think it was a suicide? So, He shows them all these gruesome crime scenes. He shows them dead pictures of Tera Chavez. He shows them guns, and then he goes, "Now see these unusual blood flows. Look at the voids and blah 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 blah," about saying that there was something wrong with the way the blood flowed. Well, the state hired Art Ortiz, and Art Ortiz said, "Hey, nothing unusual about the blood flows. As a matter of fact, that." I say, in my conclusion, the DA's expert, my investigation refutes the claim that these unusual blood flows, that they were unusual. And then the state's own expert, Mr. Van Valkenburg, the handwriting guy, says, "Yep, it's Tara's handwriting." Want to know another lie? When he tells you people, "You know, another thing real suspicious about Levi was, how did he know and how could he tell that she was shot in the head when I couldn't even tell because it was so dark in there?" Well, you gonna believe him or you gonna believe Sergeant Joseph? When I asked him, "Gee, was it really dark in there?" He goes, "The lights were on and I was the first cop that got there." And then for Deborah Romero, we can add some more lies because he really had to come down on Deborah Romero because she's an Albuquerque police officer who says that Levi was with her, and Levi was with her, and he had to do something to try his damnedest to break that down, the same way he did with Russell Perea, because Russell Perea was in effect an alibi witness. Deborah Romero was in effect an alibi witness. So he saved his hardest, worst stuff for them. But you know what happened? They turned into better witnesses for us because of the fact that they were pushed so hard by Aaron Jones, and we'll get to that in a minute. But for Deborah Romero, let's add some more lies. Effing freak. He didn't even know your name. I said, "Hey, where were you?" "I was with some effing freak." "Well, what's her name?" "Oh, I don't know. She's just some effing freak." That is disgusting. And I ask you to listen to not only the original 911 call, not only the enhanced one I did, but listen to the regular one. Listen to the one that's not enhanced. I don't care. On both of them, you'll hear that Levi says, they say, "Who are you with?" And he goes, "Oh, Deborah," something to the, I don't have it all down, but he goes, "Deborah, oh man, she'll effing freak. This is the last thing I ever wanted to get her caught up in." Words to that effect. And you could hear his voice just like that. And please listen to his voice, because Aaron Jones says that it was laughing and smirking in tone. And that's another lie that you can tell for yourself. See if you see any laughing, smirking tone in this poor man who just found the mother of his children dead. See if you see any laughing, smirking tone. Aaron Jones is a liar and a dishonest cop. For Deborah Romero, Aaron Jones also throws in that he's sleeping with a 19-year-old from Cottonwood Mall, because, of course, Deborah's older than Levi, so he wants to hit her and push her buttons where she's vulnerable. He's sleeping with a 19-year-old from Cottonwood Mall. He's sleeping with a ton of other women at the same time he's sleeping with you. And according to Levi, he actually liked Deborah. He respected Deborah. He was looking for someone that he could share his life with, because he and Tara had talked about divorce. And they were thinking about getting a divorce. And the energy between the two of them wasn't good anymore. And we're human beings, and we've all had life experiences, and you know exactly what I'm talking about. But the energy between them wasn't good anymore, and he was looking for someone else. He finally found Heather. She's supposed to be another thing to prove that he's guilty. He married the woman. She's a detective with APD. They've been married more than 5 years now. They have a child together. They live with their child and Levi's children and Heather's children as one family. He's not, it's unseemly for the district attorney's office to portray Levi's current wife as some kind of vixen. Levi was also living as husband and wife with Tara. That's what he told Deborah Romero, because Levi was, you know, really starting to get a relationship going with Deborah Romero. until this happened and until Aaron Jones stepped in. And yes, Levi did continue to call Deborah Romero afterwards. It wasn't for sex, but he did. They visited each other back and forth, and by the time Aaron Jones got to Deborah Romero, Deborah Romero didn't want anything to do with Levi anymore, because it worked. It worked to get her to hate him, and yet, she tells the truth about what she knows, and it's going to show more and more doubt about the guilt of Levi Chavez. But let's finish with Aaron Jones. He's been fired from every job he's had except two. And let's see. He was with the LA Housing Authority, and then it's all the exact same pattern in every one of his previous jobs that repeats itself in this one. Watch the similarities. Works for the LA Housing Authority, and then he notices some bad cops. So he's going to be the good cop, and he's going to uncover this horrible, nefarious activity, and he's going to be the proud, noble whistleblower. Well, I guess no one else agrees with him. They reassign him to a one-car unit and reassign him to, well, I don't know, he was already working in Section 8 housing, which I guess is like the projects. He's still in Section 8 housing, but they put him in a one-car unit, so he considers that they're trying to murder him. Remember? Oh, so they were trying to murder you? Because he says, oh, how dangerous it was, and I couldn't stay there because that's what they did to me in retaliation for me uncovering these nefarious activities. So the one job that he didn't get fired from, that one of them was because his employers at the LA Housing Authority police wanted to murder him. So he left them. He was at Lee County. When he was in Lee County, what do you know? He uncovers a crooked cop. And then he finds out information, and the sheriff promised to give, a cop promised to give a drunk guy a ride home when he shouldn't have or something or other. I don't know. He got ridden out of town on the rail, and he's fired from that one. Then he goes to work for the Cuba, New Mexico Police Department. And he says that he got a guy to brag about beating somebody up for a confession or something like that. More nefarious activities by bad cops. And then he had a tape of it or something, and the tape disappeared. At any rate, he told you he was let go by the Cuba Police Department. Then he's at the Valencia County Sheriff's Department, the place he was when he started this business. He didn't get fired from that one till later, but first he told you that he filed a federal lawsuit in that case, and he told you as a preemptive strike to avoid being fired yet again. Remember, he found out some more bad stuff and whatever. He had some case, and he managed to get his hands on some, you know, really highly sensitive videotape, and then his superiors told him to disappear that tape, deep six it. And whatever happened, he decided he would take that investigation to the feds. And he admitted the feds declined to prosecute his cockamamie case. And when he filed his lawsuit as a preemptive strike to avoid being fired, in the course of that lawsuit, and I don't know, I wasn't there, but, and you don't know everything, and you're not to consider what the report might have contained or whatever, but this is what we do know, and this is what you as jurors know about Aaron Jones. That somehow, in the middle of that federal lawsuit that he filed as the plaintiff, the judge orders him, over his objection, over the objection of his lawyer, orders him to undergo a mental examination to determine his fitness to be a police officer. And you also know that on July 6th, 2007, 3.5 months prior to the day that Tera Chavez died, That's how close it was. 3.5 months to the day Chavez died, on July 6, 2007, the court-appointed psychologist, Dr. Samuel Roll, comes back after doing a complete mental health workup on Aaron Jones and determines that he's got mental problems and is unfit to be a police officer. Now, the comeback to that is that Aaron Jones, Valencia County, somebody in Valencia County ordered up something called a fitness for duty report. It wasn't a psychological examination. It was done by a psychologist, but it wasn't called a psychological report like Dr. Rolls was. It was called a fitness for duty report. And it didn't have anything to do with the federal court, didn't have anything to do with a federal judge, it didn't have anything to do with Rule 35 of the federal rules of procedure. It just had to do with whether he could keep working now that the federal courts had determined he was unfit to be a police officer. So he got a doctor so-and-so to write him up one that says, okay, you are fit. But it didn't have anything to do with and didn't in any way undermine or change the findings of the federal court 3.5 months before Tera died. Okay, so now let's go into, you know something? I want to throw this in now. One of the Reed Method things Aaron Jones did do, and he followed it right, and he did it the way he's taught to do it, but Levi, being an innocent man, it didn't work out. And I'll tell you what I'm talking about. The state seems to think that it makes Levi look guilty that he comes home and believes his wife killed herself and doesn't consider the possibility that somebody else killed her. The fact that, you know, Aaron Jones, suicide, a word he never uttered. And the fact that he sticks with that and is unwilling to say that it might happen some other way is the way they characterize it, and therefore that makes him look bad. Actually, the opposite is true. There is something called a bait question, and that's what Aaron Jones was doing. A bait question is when a police officer asks a suspect something, trying to get them to lie to expose their guilt. So the bait questions for Levi Chavez, and you can hear it if you listen to the interview again when Aaron Jones gets there, he says, well, did you ever think maybe somebody might have broken in? Remember Mr. McCann, who talked about how in staging a crime, the criminal always wants to deflect the suspicion away from him and on to someone else? Okay, well, it's the same way with the bait question. You ask somebody, could it have been something else? You think maybe there might have been a break-in? A guilty man would say, yeah, maybe that's what it was. Yeah, break-in, you're on the right track. An innocent man would say, no, I don't think it was a break-in. Well, do you think maybe somebody had good grounds? Next bait question. You think maybe somebody else was out to murder her? That's designed to get Levi to say, hey, you know, I think maybe there were. Let me look into that. I think maybe somebody was out to get her. Let me think about who her enemies were. That's who somebody that takes the bait. An innocent man says, no, I don't know anybody that would want to harm my wife. So Aaron Jones did one thing right in his questioning, but because he had an innocent man, it didn't work out for him. Remember, I even showed Aaron Jones the bit about from his interview, where he says, well, I don't want to make too much hullabaloo out of this, because if I do, everybody's going to go, oh boy, there goes Aaron Jones again. Remember that? He already knew he had a rep as being a cuckoo. Well, now, let's talk about a couple of the women. And I want to start by talking about Rose Slama. Rose Slama There's two statements that the state wants you to believe that Rose Salama made, okay? One of them is that one day when Tera was cutting Rose Salama's hair, they have this haircutter client relationship. Just during a haircut, Tera goes, "Oh, by the way, you know something? My truck wasn't really stolen. Levi is doing it for insurance fraud." Well, isn't that weird that none of her friends that she talks to umpteen times a day, calls, texts, etc., all of them knew about the stolen truck. None of them said anything that Tera had made such a claim that Levi was involved in it. Only Rose Salama. Does that make any sense at all? Does that make any sense at all? But, so the statement wasn't made. And then she claims that she told Levi. It's sort of a two-parter. That then Rose Salama goes and tells Levi, "Hey Levi, Tara's saying you had something to do with the car theft." And prosecutor gets up and goes, "Oh, but it doesn't matter if the car was stolen. We don't care if the car was stolen. We just care that Levi killed Tera because Tera told Rose that Levi was involved, and Rose told Levi that Levi was involved, and so that must be why Levi killed her." Well, remember this? The investigation concluded that the allegations were unfounded. Now think about that, and it doesn't take thinking very hard. Would you go and kill somebody if they told a lie about you that you knew was unfounded? If Rose Salama came up to Levi and said, "Hey Levi, you know what? Tera seems to think that you were John F. Kennedy's assassin. I'm gonna kill somebody because they say something that is completely unfounded?" So Levi supposedly killed his wife, not because she was talking about a crime that he did, but because she was telling false tales about him. She was talking trash about her husband, so therefore he killed her. Come on. Okay, but then we got the other instruction that makes it even stranger. And that's the one that says that you are not to even consider whether what, here it is, no, wait. Ah, the testimony of Rose Salama about what Tera Chavez allegedly said to Rose Salama is not being offered to imply that what Tera Chavez said was true. Okay, so you can't even consider it true. You are instructed not to consider whether the statements allegedly made by Tera Chavez were true. You are only to consider whether such statement was made and whether such statement was a motive. The bottom of the barrel, killing your wife because she's talking trash. That's one of their motives. We're going to talk about the moving targets. Moving targets about how it happened, moving targets about motives. The state doesn't have a case. They're floundering around for 6 years or whatever it's been, and this is what you got. So, Rose Salama, here's the other statement. Rose Salama goes around repeating a rumor that she heard that Levi was in the shower when Tera died. It's not even that Levi murdered her. That Levi was in the shower when Tera died, and he came out and found her dead. Well, that's ridiculous, but the state's got to grab onto something, don't they? So, so she's saying, and she tells Aaron Jones, "No, that was one of many rumors I heard. I also heard that she got shot in the stomach. I heard this, I heard that. That's one of the things I heard." And she repeats it and repeats it and repeats it. And then, what timing, what exquisite timing. 8 days after she's charged with her first set of felonies involving dishonesty, she goes in for a deposition. And at the deposition, she says for the very first time ever to anybody that that the state brought in, anybody that, well, let me put it this way. The state was talking to Ms. Slama on the witness stand and said, well, you told the ladies at the school that too, didn't you? Tell the assistant principal or assistant teacher's aide or whatever it was. You told the people at the school that Levi told you he was in the shower, right? Oh, yes, I did. I told it to the school. So you've said it before, right? Right. Well, did the state bring up one single person to back up Rose Slama? Did any women from the school, you'd think I would if I were a prosecutor, that, got a little bit of credibility problem with Rose Slama, better bring in some solid people to back her up, or that ain't gonna fly. But they didn't. We just got Rose Slama and Rose Slama alone. And then she gets set charged with another set of felonies. Also, these ones involve crimes of dishonesty. Then she gets charged with a third set of felonies, each one of these involving crimes of dishonesty. Let's see. She's been charged with welfare fraud, multiple counts, fraud, forgery, larceny, identity theft. This is the one that the DA's office wants you to believe so that you can find Levi Chavez, who's never been accused of a crime in his life, guilty of murder one. Not only that, but she says, I talked to Levi on the phone, and Levi told me that he was in the shower. We got here somewhere, don't know where, but we got here somewhere, one of these exhibits, because you saw me show them to her. Oh, here they are. I made them for my convenience. That would be, and write this down, because I don't have a little razzle-dazzle to show you. Defendant's Exhibit E. Remember that this search of phone calls between Levi Chavez and Rose Slama, they've got all of them any time from September 4th, 07 to December 12th, 07. The calls don't come in like she said they did on the time period. The first call involving Levi Chavez is not until October 23rd. At any rate, I showed her that. She didn't have an answer. The DA's best thing was, well, this is how we can explain it. When Rose Slama texts, she means, I talked to him on the phone and he said, oh no, she meant text. She meant text. That's why it's not there, because that doesn't have texts. You starting to get some reasonable doubt, folks? No phone calls between Levi and Rose Slama during the time period that the state claims it. Boy, are we glad. Are we happy that all of these different law enforcement agencies and the district attorney's office and a lawyer hired by the court of us to sue him got all of this stuff? We're really happy that they got all of this stuff, because this stuff shows, after covering every aspect of Levi's life, that they can't show. They can't make a case. They can't even show that he was in Valencia County the 20th or the 21st. There's zero zip evidence that Levi was even in the county when this thing happened. They had a witness, Jeannie Morrow, but then she said, oops. They don't even have nothing. Nobody says that Levi was even in the county. No evidence from any source says that Levi was even in the same county as Tera Chavez. Rose Slama should be, her testimony should be wadded up like a ball and thrown in the trash. She insults the integrity of a court of law. Russell Perea. Let's talk about Russell Perea for a second. The thin blue line or whatever. Russell Perea didn't even want to be here. Did he come in and go, yeah, I'm his cohort in crime, I'm gonna say, well, no. He didn't want to be here, he refused to come here. And why? Because Aaron Jones had threatened him. He gave a deposition, he told the truth in his deposition, then Aaron Jones shows up at his office, his police office, and sticks him in a room, and Russ just talks to him, keeps on talking to him. The interview lasts 3 hours, during which he is, Russ Perez, browbeaten by Aaron Jones and told, you lied in your deposition. You painted yourself into a corner. You better cooperate with us now, or else things really bad is going to happen to you. I've got the authorization right now to decapitate your employment with APD. So he cooperates with him. And guess what Aaron Jones does? Drops a dime, decapitates him from APD. Well, Russell Perea gets a lawyer, appeals the decision. The Albuquerque City Personnel Board says unanimously that not only did he not lie in his deposition, but there weren't even grounds to believe that he had done anything wrong, and unanimously recommends that he gets his job back as a police officer and that he get all his back pay and benefits. So, Russell Perea didn't want to be here because I guess that appeal process is still going on. And the last thing he wants to do is have himself thrust into a case where he's going to be an alibi witness that's getting media coverage when he's trying to keep things kind of low-key so he can get his job back. He had to be, as he told you, ordered, compelled by Judge Eichwald to come in here and testify. And what did he tell you? He told you that Levi Chavez was genuine with him the entire time, that they were riding in a two-man unit, that Levi was the driver and he kind of bounced around from different cops, but when he rode with Levi, Levi was funny, Levi was personable, Levi was a good cop, Levi was genuine. Levi never left the West Side Area Command. Levi never came in late or took off early. And by the way, Levi's sergeant, the one that's pursuing the degree in theology, he also told you Levi was very professional, very punctual, always on time, never late, getting there, never early, taking off. The reason we brought that out is because that was one of the moving targets. At one point, the state was making us go through some of their 20,000 pages worth of evidence that said that he'd killed Tera when he was on duty as an APD officer, and that he and APD went, wink, wink, we'll look the other way while you run down there and kill her and then come back, because we're the thin blue line and we don't care if you murder your wife. What the heck? That was then. So we had to bring in Russell Perea, because Levi was with Russell Perea. Aaron Jones was doing his damnedest to keep Russell Perea from ever seeing this courtroom, and says, excuse me. Anyway, that theory went out the window. Now we're told that it was when he was supposed to be with Deborah Romero that he hustled on down to Las Lunas and killed her. But at one point, that's Russell Perea. Don't you know that, Deborah, as a police officer? The lights off were in the house, and he couldn't even remember your name. It was like pulling teeth. We said, what's her name? And he goes, F, I don't know, just some if and freak. He's sleeping with 19-year-olds. He's got tons of women, and he was living with Tara as husband and wife. She hates Levi. Because what Jones did partially did the trick. And it was probably the effing freak and the sleeping with women younger, because he's probably, you know, you saw her, you heard me talking to her. She's a little sensitive that she's a little older than Levi, or 10 years older, or whatever. He's sleeping with all these young kids. Okay, so check this out. Jones tells Deborah Romero, oh, Levi is a very, very slick, wily individual. He's extremely smart. He's into all of these secret agent things. He's extremely brilliant criminal. You better watch out, Deborah Romero. And what does Deborah say? And this is after she's gotten the whole full Monty treatment of what an evil, horrible, guilty man Levi is. She goes, no. Very, very slick and wily individual. Deborah goes, no. Matter of fact, in my opinion, he was pretty immature and he was pretty naive. Oops for Aaron Jones. Then Aaron Jones goes, but you see, he's so slick and he's so wily. Don't you understand? You're a police officer. If he sets you up in advance to be an unwitting alibi, not knowing it, set it up so that he could be with you and then he could run off and go kill somebody. Yeah. And then Deborah Romero goes, no, I'm the one that picked that weekend. Matter of fact, I wanted to do it the weekend before, but Levi was on military training, or whatever the deal is. I don't remember all those details. But she said back to him again and again, no, sorry, Jones, oops for you, I'm the one that picked that weekend. Now, you remember she was very feisty. She didn't want to be here. She said so several times. She told me to hurry up and so she could get the heck out of here. You know, what's your point? What's your point? She was saying to me. She didn't like being here. I can't blame her. Who would? Who would? But, and the DA got her to say, and the DA got her to stick with, I don't know what time it is when he arrived. Because Aaron Jones had worked on her and worked on her and worked on her, trying to destroy the statement that she had made that Levi came straight over to her house after work and stayed with her just like he had the night before. And the DA's office and the Cordova family and their lawyers and the Valencia County Sheriff's Office, headed up by Aaron Jones, who still had the case at that time. That was before the Valencia County Sheriff's Office said, you know what, we've done run out of leads on this Levi Chavez thing. You know, I think this ain't gone nowhere. It don't look like he's a murderer, okay? That incensed Aaron Jones to the point where he calls his own press conference and says about his own supervisors, oh, you don't know what the heck they're talking about. They should be ashamed of themselves. And he gets formally reprimanded again. And then he keeps on working there. That's when the Captain Cupcake and whatever happened. And then he keeps on working there for a while, but then he's discovering more nefarious activities. Only now his computer is being monitored. Every keystroke of his computer at his own place of work in the sheriff's department, a law enforcement agency, every keystroke is being monitored. And I asked him, who's monitoring your keystrokes? They of the unseen hand. This is the one that the state is putting all their hopes and dreams, and the Cordovas are putting all their hopes and dreams that you'll and the Cordovas lawyer is putting all his hopes and dreams that you'll convict Levi Chavez on Aaron Jones. Okay, so anyway, back to Deborah Romero. Even though they beat her down to the point where she would have to stick with, I don't know what time it was. Is it time for bed or no? No? I want to keep going. Okay. So they did get her to say, I do not know what time it was when he came in the door. And she stuck to that. And that's why I kept saying to her, okay, ma'am, that's fine. I accept that. You do not know where the big hand and the little hand were when he crossed the threshold. However, Ms. Romero, you have on many occasions given objective factors to narrow that down, so that it's not just a big window that he got there somewhere between 12:30 and 6 a.m. And so I said, I pointed out to her what she had said before, that he couldn't have got there any later than 3 a.m., that was the first one, because she was expecting him. And when she was expecting him, She would sleep on the couch. And by the way, this wasn't the first time he had ever spent the night there, and it wasn't the second time he had ever spent the night there either. And don't be bamboozled. Look at your own notes. See if anywhere in your notes anybody writes down that Deborah Romero said this was only the first or second time Levi had ever been there. Anyway, when she's expecting him, she sleeps on the couch. Because of the way she tends to wake up and go to sleep and wake up and go to sleep when she is expecting Levi, she automatically knows that it couldn't have even been any later than 1 o'clock. And so every time I tried to ask her that, because she was here and it was so humiliating for her, she called it disgusting. And I'm sure it was disgusting for her. And I feel sorry for her that she had to come in. But every time she would say, I don't know what time he came in. And then I would go back to her. Finally, I said, okay, I'll tell you what. Let's not go back to whatever statements you gave years ago. Let's go back to the statement you gave a month ago. How about the one you got a month ago? You think you can remember that one? I wasn't rude to her, but... okay, so let's talk about a month ago. And we came out and we marked the pages and she came down and I said, okay, read these lines. This is what you said a month ago. Question, would you agree with the statement you gave a little bit earlier that because of where you were sleeping and the fact that you were expecting Levi, that you think it's real unlikely that he would have gotten there as late as 3 a.m.? Answer. I still feel the same. Yes. Question. You still feel the same way? Yes. Yes. Okay. So when he said when was the last time he probably got there, you said probably 1 o'clock. It couldn't have been any later than that. Probably 1 o'clock. It couldn't have been any later than that. And then I ask her, do you still agree with that? Answer, yes. This is a month before she testified. Then I ask her again, and remember, I'm asking her, did you say this a month ago? Yes. Has anything changed in the last month? No. Did you? Okay, next question. Did I ask you this question? Yes. Did you answer this way? Yes. Has anything changed since then? No. Okay, then I ask her this one. All-encompassing. And you tell us that after having read all your statements and your deposition, that to the best of your knowledge, he couldn't have got there any later than 1 a.m.? Answer, yes. Okay. And again, that's because you tend to wake up periodically when you were expecting Levi? Answer, yes. So, I say to you this, which alibi witness is more believable? Somebody who is a member of a thin blue line that just is gung-ho, you bet he was with me the whole time and that's my story and I'm sticking to it? Or somebody who doesn't want to be here, who hates your client, and who still says that he was acting totally normally, that he is not very slick and wily, but is naive and immature, that she's the one that picked the weekend, that he couldn't have got there any later than 1 a.m., that they went out all day Sunday, after he supposedly killed his wife and then came back. They went out, they went to a restaurant, they went to Starbucks, they went to Barnes & Noble, they went to a movie. He was behaving completely normally because that was her testimony. What is a better alibi witness? Somebody that says those good things for your client when they hate your client and tell you from the witness stand that they don't want to be here? And same with Russell Perea. Did he say, yes, sir, gung-ho, and that's my story? No. He said that the only reason he came to that box is because the judge compelled him by court order to come in and testify. And yet, both of those people said that Levi Chavez was with them. Closed the window of opportunity of Levi Chavez to go hustling back to Las Lunas and kill his wife. And you know what else? Not only, excuse me, not only do they not have any witness or any evidence of any other sort, be it computer or telephone or cell phone power pinging or anything that shows Levi Chavez was even in the same county that weekend. Not only that, but what a horrible system we have to have. We don't have to have it. What a horrible system we would have if our fate could be determined because we happen to turn off our cell phone. I don't know about you, but I'm chicken at turning off my cell phone now. Might be accused of murder. You know, let me tell you something. If Levi is such a wily, slick individual, and he supposedly knows about all these pingings, and he supposedly goes to Deborah Romero's house to show he's there, and then turns off his phone so he can go do his murderous deeds, if he's so knowledgeable about this stuff, wouldn't it have been easy to just get his cell phone when he got to Deborah Romero's house and stash it under a bush or something? And then the pings would show him right there at Deborah Romero's house the whole time. He could get his phone, stash it under a bush at Deborah Romero's house, go kill her, come back, and all these records would show that he was in Albuquerque. But that's not what happened, because he didn't kill her. And it is... there's a lack of evidence, and they want you to convict Levi based on the lack of evidence. Levi already told you about the no more tears thing, and haven't you guys heard that in your lives before? It doesn't mean that you hate somebody or that you're rude. Levi said, gosh, I wouldn't have said it, you know, in a rude way. Mr. Cordova probably would have attacked me. Remember, Levi, he's even...
All right.
Thank you, Your Honor. You know, in many ways, the Cordova family, they're victims of Aaron Jones, too. They got together with Aaron Jones that night, and they had long-standing animosity toward Levi, yeah. And they have old family gossip, and they have an absolute refusal to entertain a single thought that Tara was anything other than happy-go-lucky and headed into her bright future of happiness. And we know that's not the case. But in many ways, their long-standing hatred of Levi played into what Aaron Jones did. Because Aaron Jones saw, when he met Joseph Cordova, even though he saw no red flags that night, he saw an opportunity to jack around with the police department, his favorite pastime. Levi Chavez, APD officer, ooh, he's reading about, ooh, APDs are bad cops, and he can be another, there goes Aaron Jones again. And then you throw in the Cordova's lawyer, and you got the little engine that could and did make it into a courtroom, even without evidence. So, of course, Jones brought his law enforcement muscle. Cordova's lawyer brought a subpoena machine to crank out depositions and documents and get everything possible, and brought in their connection to the local press as well. But, you know, had I not crossed, and then for rebuttal, the state is going to rebut the whole defense case, and they rebut the whole defense case by bringing back Joseph Cordova. And I feel very, very sorry, and I feel great sympathy for the entire Cordova family. And, you know, that being said, had I not cross-examined Mr. Cordova, you would have been left with the impression, based on his testimony, that Levi never gave our family any of Tara's belongings. Absolutely nothing, is what he told you. I had to get up there, and it didn't take long before he remembered that when he came on to testify the first time, he said that little Levi came up to him and said, quote, "Dad wants to know if you want these in a box." Forgot that. If I hadn't cross-examined him, you would be under the impression that this guardianship was done just for health insurance. And I'm not, believe me, I'm not beating up victims. Yes, it was for health insurance. And yes, they got that unborn health insurance the day that child was born. And God bless the court of us for doing that. But it wasn't only for that, because when I cross-examined him, we learned, and you'll learn it in State's Exhibit 221, that although they asked for temporary guardianship so that they could get health insurance, they also said that they wanted to define their rights with regard to the child. And hey, grandparents' rights, I'm all for it, that's fine. It's just not what Joseph Cordova testified to, and wait till I get to this. Then the order, State's Exhibit 222, it doesn't say it's temporary, says they're just appointed guardians. And it doesn't say anything about insurance. Nope. And it doesn't even include Levi or Tara as guardians at all of the child. And Mr. Cordova said, well, it was supposed to. The order, I said, look, the order says the guardians are Tara, excuse me, that the guardians are you and your wife. Well, it was supposed to include Levi and Tara. But then an interesting thing, he started talking about, I said, well, wait a minute. Levi ended up getting a lawyer and ended up having to go to arbitration. Yes, that's because Levi demanded more visitation than he was getting. What? Visitation? Visitation? He needs to hire a lawyer to get more visitation of his own son? Do you wonder, do you think that maybe Levi Chavez at age 16 might think that they were trying to take away his baby? Because they called the court to show that Levi was a liar on the witness stand. Do you think that a 16-year-old might think that grown-ups are trying to take away his baby when he has to hire a lawyer to get greater visitation rights of his own baby? There's nothing that makes... Well, okay. So let me go on and talk now a little bit about the experts. I'm hoping, and I feel confident, because you guys are all sharp, and we picked you all to be jurors, because you all said, you each one of us promised us, one at a time, when we were meeting with you individually, that you would demand that the state prove the guilt and prove it beyond the reasonable doubt. And we chose you as jurors for that reason. So we're confident that you're going to remember what was said on that witness stand that passed for proof. The DA is flashing up his thing, saying that it was wiped clean. No, it wasn't wiped clean. The fingerprint lady said that there were partial fingerprint impressions with insufficient ridge characteristics. And Mr. McCann told you, you know, the ridge characteristic, the little whorls and swirls or whatever they're called, and you have to have a certain number of them to match fingerprints. So what does that mean? That means that whoever was there did not wipe it clean, or you wouldn't have partial latent impressions with insufficient ridge characteristics. What else does it mean? That the person wasn't wearing gloves to hide their fingerprints, because there were fingerprints. There were just insufficient ridge characteristics on those fingerprints, so it wasn't wiped clean, and nobody was wearing gloves, okay? You know, then when I asked her about the wiped clean, her answer was kind of coy, because you got to realize these people do work for police and they are state's witnesses and they do want convictions, and it doesn't help the state's case that that there are fingerprints, you know, but they can't identify them because there aren't ridge characteristics. She said, I asked her, well, in fact, this is the only question I asked her. So you didn't find any evidence that the surfaces you checked for fingerprints were wiped clean, did you? And her answer was, quote, I couldn't determine that they had been. Now listen, the state turns it around to say, I couldn't determine whether or not. Well, of course she can determine whether or not. There are fingerprints there. It's just that she couldn't match them. What she meant, listen carefully and use your semantics here. I couldn't determine that they had been wiped clean. That's not the same thing as I couldn't determine whether or not. I couldn't determine that they had means no. If my wife says, hey David, would you look outside the picture window and see if our lawn's on fire? And I look out there and it's not, and I say, honey, I couldn't determine that it is on fire. It means, I couldn't determine means no, okay? All right, so then we got the DNA lady. Now the state's got a big problem, because now the latest state's theory that we're hearing for the first time when we got into court here is that the gun that Tara died by was never even in the house. That Levi brought it in. Well, we know Levi carries his Kimber for his duty weapon. Did they rebut that at all? But now they get up and want you to think that Levi's carrying the Glock. Anyway, the lady says, I hope you remember her testimony, that she took two swabs for the DNA on the gun. That one swab, she swabbed the muzzle of the gun. And the muzzle of the gun tested presumptive positive for blood. Remember, there's this stuff, and it's, you know, just a quick test, and presumptive positive for blood. But then she told you that she took, I'm taking this thing out here, if I can make it come out, that she looked around here, she took swabs from around this little line she made, and that's where she swabbed it, and that this one with the second swab did not test positive for the presence of blood on the hand grip. Blood on the muzzle, no blood on the presumptive test on the hand grip. And she said that the hand grip showed a mixture of DNA of Tara and Levi. See, that's a big problem for the state, because what the heck is Tara's DNA doing on the handle of the gun if the gun was never in the house? And so the DA, when cross-examining her, says, well, something like, you sure you didn't get any blood on that? Or she goes, well, I tried my best to avoid blood, but I can't be 100% sure that I didn't get any blood, because she's trying to help the state out. And so, you know, she's wanting, and so then of course the state goes and tries to confront our experts with, well, did you know that most of the blood, or most of the DNA on that hand grip came from her blood? Well, no, that's not the case, and the witness cannot be and should not be allowed in a court of law to bamboozle you into some testimony that, well, Tara's blood was only on the, I mean, Tara's DNA was only on the hand grip because I might not have been able to totally avoid any blood. And so, yeah, that explains why Tara's DNA is on the hand grip, because it might be some blood. well, that sure doesn't square with the fact that she did a test on the muzzle, yes, blood. Test on the hand grip, no blood. Starting to feel some reasonable doubt here. Okay. She's also the lady that told you that there was an unknown male hair, but that they could have sent it out to another lab to test mitochondrial DNA, and they never did, and we talked about that. Let's talk about Mr. Radosovic. I like Mr. Radosovic. Mr. Radosovic is pretty much a straight shooter. Well, he is a straight shooter. Why hold back? He's a straight shooter. He told you, and what's a DA say? Oh, gee, supposedly some video, but we never saw it. I didn't have to show it because I was cross-examining Mr. Radosovic, and I said, you saw that video, didn't you? I provided the video to the DA, Mr. McKay, and he provided it to you to watch it, and you saw it, didn't you? Yes, and he was impressed. He was impressed. He said, yeah, McCann did that. He got the head, was able to get the gun upside down. This is the way it works. He's holding the gun upside down, and then pushing the trigger that would somehow make this release button here go down. But he couldn't, he had to use a live round because, as he told you, and by the way, Radosovic said the same thing, that when the gun is fired, it tends to slightly rotate clockwise. Therefore, when it's upside down, it would tend to rotate slightly counterclockwise. And so if you're holding the gun like this to kill yourself, and the gun, when you push down on the trigger and you're using your thumb because you're a little petite woman, there's no ammunition in this. When you're a little petite woman, so you're using your thumb like most women use to commit suicide, the experts have told us, and you're holding a gun like this, and so when the slide kicks back, it's not going to touch your fingers at all, and these two fingers are going to be up like Tara's two fingers were. When you're pulling the trigger with your thumb, when the bullet fires, it rotates, and so this little release button is pushed into your thumb at the same time that your thumb is pushed into the release button. And it all happens in a fraction of a second. And it's involuntary. It happens with the same motion that you use to pull the trigger with your thumb. That same motion propels your thumb forward. The gun is rotating slightly counterclockwise, pushing the release button into your thumb, and that's what happened. I asked Mr. McCann to get up and show you what I just showed you. I did not ask him, like some people seem to think, to do a demonstration of what he did on the video. That's ridiculous. You would need a live round. When you're here in a courtroom, you can't go firing bullets off because when you fire a bullet, it's a controlled explosion inside the chamber. And it makes the bullet shoot out like that and the slide come back with powerful recoil. And we're not gonna do that in a courtroom. But that's what has to happen to make what happened happen. And that's how it happened. What he did do, he was wearing gloves. And apparently, I didn't ask him to do this, but apparently while he was sitting there, he was fiddling around trying to do it. Well, he was wearing gloves. That's not only is that not the same condition as Tara about to commit suicide with cold, sweaty hands and no gloves on. These are friction gloves that keep that. This inhibits what happened to Tara from happening. When you're about to commit suicide and your hands are sweating, that promotes it. So we couldn't do the experiment in court, and Mr. McCann did not attempt to do the demonstration in court because he couldn't have done the demonstration because he couldn't have done the counterclockwise rotation without shooting a bullet in the courtroom. Anyway, Radosovic was impressed. He thought that McCann was some kind of an expert trick shooter or something, and McCann is actually just an ex-cop who's a crime scene analyst, but he's one of the top crime scene analysts in the nation. And I don't like him being called a jack of all trades and a master of none. That is a knowledgeable, super intelligent, and extremely warm and kind human being. And he told you that for years and years and years he worked as a police officer, and he went into private practice as a crime scene analyst, and for years he wouldn't take a criminal defense case. He refused to take a criminal defense case. And in time he learned that sometimes the criminal justice system makes mistakes. Sometimes people get charged who shouldn't be charged. And so he looks into the case and he sees what we have here or not. So the first thing that Radosevich does is he looks at the gun and he makes up a report, writes up a report. He gets the gun in May of 09, okay? And so he writes a report on August 12th. And remember I showed him that report? And he writes it to the DA, the DA in charge of the case. And all the report talks about, 2 pages long, all it talks about is the gun and how it functions, and it shoots okay, and the trigger pull weight is this, and the blah, blah, blah. It talks about all the specifications of the gun, and that's it. That's August 12th, 09. Then he has some concerns, and he starts thinking to himself, at these photographs, from the photographs, I don't know. Maybe the gun is seated, maybe the gun isn't seated. And if the gun isn't seated, then how could another round get in the chamber? Maybe there is something suspicious about this, but only if the gun is unseated. And so he goes and he finds out. Remember he said, I need to find out who is the first person to actually handle the gun. Who was the first person to actually handle the gun? Oh God, look who volunteers. Me, Aaron Jones, I handled it. It was unseated. Oh yeah, it was unseated. So now we got nobody to back up Aaron Jones that the gun was unseated. Nobody, nobody, nobody. He was in the room there with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, how many other cops and photographers and everybody else walking around one little bedroom. And not one of them was willing to come into court here and back Aaron Jones up that the gun was unseated in the same room. Nor did he say to anybody, excuse me, my fellow officers, look what I've just noticed, an unseated gun. This is of evidentiary importance. No, he doesn't say nothing. He says it sometime in September of 2009, about 2 years after Tera dies, because then he writes a second report 1.5 months after his August 12th report, 09, and there he writes, Jones told me that the gun was unseated and the magazine was stuck with blood, and Aaron Jones was able to just tug on the bottom and it came out without the magazine release button having to be pressed. Think about that. 2 years after Tera dies, May, June, July, August, September, 4 months after having the gun, and 2 years after Tera dies, he finds out this new important fact that Aaron Jones claims the gun was unseated. Remember I showed him the statement of probable cause? Statement of probable cause means the evidence you got on the guy. This is my statement of probable cause. This is the evidence that I got to show that Levi Chavez is probably guilty. Doesn't say anything about a gun being unseated. And then we go all the way in August 12, 2000. That's why we know that this unseated business came up for the first time somewhere between August 12th, 2009 and September 24th, 2009. You heard the evidence. Now, think about this, remember? If an officer gets a weapon and it's lying there and you're a cop, what's the first thing a cop does? Secure the weapon. And what's the first best thing to secure the weapon?
You grab it, you push the release button, and you pull the thing out. It's automatic. That's what a police officer does. And remember, the gun didn't know, you couldn't tell from looking at the gun whether it was seated or unseated. So, remember, it was even called muscle memory. That what does an officer do? He wants to unseat a gun. Why would he start tugging on it instead of doing what officers do? Secure the gun, make it safe, push the button, pull the thing out, and then you go like that, and you rack it, and so that if there's a bullet in the chamber, that's out too, and you make it, you render it safe. So any law enforcement officer would automatically push the release button. Muscle memory. Jones' story is that for some reason, when he's trying to render the gun safe, he just decides to tug on it. And there's a picture, I think, in there somewhere, too. Okay, so Mr. Radosevich says, and this is really important, remember this little line here that everybody took and looked at, and it's some kind of like a little line there, and then there's like a width of a quarter or something. Anyway, and notice how the lines are irregular. You kind of have to contrast it against the light a little bit, but it's kind of like kind of drippy or wavy on both sides there. Okay? So the theory of Mr. Radosevich for the prosecution, and it's a plausible theory, I suppose, is that the red line is right here. The red line is right here, but guess what? There's no red line there. There's no red line there. So I said to him, well, isn't it possible that the blood dripping down from Tera landing on here could just drip down into that magazine well? It could drip down into that magazine well and keep going, flowing down between the magazine and the magazine well. And he says, yeah, that's plausible. That's plausible, okay? So the photographs didn't tell Radosevich seated or unseated. The line on the magazine did not tell Radosevich seated or unseated because he said it's equally plausible that it was seated and the red line was caused by the blood flowing under there. The three things that Radosevich relied on, or that the state tells you to rely on, is one, the photos. Nope, Radosevich had questions about the photos, but he couldn't determine unseated by the photos. Two, the blood line on the magazine, but he told you, no, it's also plausible that that line was created by the blood flowing with the magazine fully seated. So what does that leave? That leaves Aaron Jones. That's what tipped the scale for Radosevich, because the poor guy, bless his heart, thinks that Jones is a legitimate officer. And so, what does that mean? That means this whole thing that makes the whole gun suspicious, that it all supposedly boils down to, who's the one that is coming forth with that information? Again, Aaron Jones and only Aaron Jones. Now, Radosevich and the OMI doctor McFeely said that no one could intentionally, voluntarily depress the button after they'd been shot, and that's true. But we know that Tera, from Dr. McFeely, we know that there are some involuntary bodily functions, such as the hemoaspiration, or meaning taking a few involuntary breaths and blood went into her lungs, and that is proof that she took some breaths. So even though she had her brain stem severed, she was taking a breath or more. That's involuntary function, the same kind of involuntary function that propels the thumb to keep going when you're so scared and you're going to kill yourself, and you say, okay, I'm going to do it, Now, Mr. McCann found that what Art Ortiz had thought was a small elliptical stain, he showed, and you can look at the photographs yourself, that it was actually a stain wicking blood away from the body. Art Ortiz thought it might be suspicious because it seemed to be all by itself.
And how does a blood drop get there by itself? Well, for one thing, when the thing fall, it could have dripped off the muzzle when the gun's falling after the shot. But Mr. McCann was able to find from photographs that Art Ortiz was not able to find the same exact spot before it was compressed down by the ruler. You take a look at that. I'm not going to waste a lot of time with that because I got some ground to cover. But Art Ortiz agreed with him. Yeah, you know something? Well, didn't 100% agree, but didn't refute it. Said, you know what, Mr. Serna, that could be a wicking stain. Because Mr. McCann is not a hired gun. And Art Wetley, the forensic pathologist, is not a hired gun. And Berman's not a hired gun. These people have impeccable credentials. These people are the tops in the nation. Because Levi Chavez is an innocent man and did not want to go down. He wanted to bring people here that can show what looks to be a semi-believable made-up case is not a case at all. These are the tops in the nation. You heard their credentials. And you listened to them testify. And you know, Mr. McCann told you, remember about the no third-party involvement? Remember in the staging? And I talked to you about the bait question, where in a bait question, a guilty person deflects the guilt away from them toward somebody else. Well, same deal with staging a murder to look like a suicide. You don't have the guy that did the murder who's trying to make it look like a suicide be the guy that discovers the body. You conveniently arrange, if you're a guilty man, to have somebody else come by and find it and go, and call up the husband, oh my goodness, I've just found your wife. Or you go there with somebody and you say, come on, Joe, I've got a new fishing reel I want to show you. Oh my God, Tara. That's what you do so that you can have somebody with you or somebody else can do it and blame can be deflected away from you. I mean, you defeat the whole purpose of staging if you're a guilty criminal, if then you stage it real nice and then you're the guy that comes and sees it, you know? Mr. McKay says, oh, it could have been those kids. It could have been those kids. But you know what? It wasn't those kids. When Levi was at his mom's house and his mom started telling him about how she couldn't get a hold of Tara, and when Levi already knew about the 300 and some calls that just stopped after, I think I'm going to hurt myself, he went straight over there. Now, if he was a murderer, he would say, Mom, Gino, why don't you guys go check on Tara? I sure am tired. Why don't you go check on Tara? Or called anybody else and said, why don't you go check on Tara? But he didn't do that. He went there himself. He's did what a stager doesn't do. Mr. McCann. Now, Dr. Wetley also tops in his field. He showed that there was, first, a lack of any knee injuries to her mouth, the inside of the mouth that would show somebody trying to resist. That if you're trying to shove a gun in somebody's mouth, then number one, you're likely to get some kind of contusions or something on the lips. And he wrote the Atlas of Forensic Psychology. And in his Atlas of Forensic Psychology, he wrote a chapter or whatever it was about intraoral gunshot wounds. And included in his atlas is a photograph of another person that has an intraoral gunshot wound. This is for forensic pathologists that are just kind of like regular ones. Dr. Wetley is like the, you know, master teacher of this stuff. He writes the textbooks that regular forensic pathologists use. And he showed that the injuries to Tera are what the injuries are here. And I asked him very specifically, a man who knows better than probably anybody else in this country, is, could the bruising there be due to somebody shoving that in her mouth? No. This is the classic bruising that comes from an intraoral gunshot wound. Here's my atlas with my photograph showing you the same thing. Well, Dr. Wedley, wouldn't you, wouldn't somebody resist? You know, I'm sorry we had to have that picture of the tongue. I wanted not to have to do that. But to show you that if you try to shove a gun in somebody's mouth who's either sleepy but not asleep, or asleep but able to be roused, both people, everybody said that even if she were asleep, that she would be readily rousable with that amount of diphenhydramine in her system. Wouldn't you go, hey, what up, and move your head from side to side and cause some cuts on your upper soft palate or on your tongue or on the sides of your cheeks or something like that? No image of that whatsoever, no evidence of it. And wouldn't you go, wait, what are you doing? What are you doing? And get your hands like that and push somebody away? If you're asleep, wrong way, what's going on? Wouldn't there be some evidence? Dr. Wedley says, you bet there would be, and there wasn't. Now, somebody who takes a bunch of Tylenol to either calm themselves down because they're about to commit suicide, not Tylenol, Benadryl, or a mixture or whatever the stuff is that we talked about that has a sedative effect, but not enough to render you knocked out. You might want to take that stuff to steel yourself, to calm yourself down a little bit, to maybe even affect the gag reflex so that you can slowly push that gun back as far as it'll go so you know you can do the job right, and then with your thumb, does that make more sense, or does it make sense that Levi would come walking in and just like that? That doesn't even make sense. How could he have that? That would cause a reaction from someone. When you're doing it to yourself, there wouldn't be any injury, just like there wasn't any injury. So, Dr. Wedley also told you about a scholarly article that he published in the Journal of Forensic whatever it was. And that it was the article about a number of suicides, this phenomenon where in several cases they found someone, didn't know whether they were a suicide victim, thought perhaps they weren't because they were shot dead with a revolver, but the cylinder for the revolver had popped open. And Dr. Wedley told you about a series of those and how he had been involved in the investigation and consulting with all of those and put it all together to show for the benefit of other forensic pathologists around the country that just because the gun cylinder is open and in one case even bullets spilling out, in one case bullets even spilling out under the body, that don't make it a homicide. And he was able to investigate and show that the suicide victim shot themselves, and then their finger continued through and hit the cylinder release. Very similar situation. And he told you about his scholarly articles that he's written for other pathologists about that very thing. Are you convinced beyond a reasonable doubt still that Levi is guilty? You know, I don't know if you all noticed, I hope you did, But the DA's office flew in Dr. McFeely from South Dakota or wherever the heck she lives to sit in the audience when Dr. Wedley was testifying so that they could call her up to rebut Dr. Wedley. She sat there, listened to Dr. Wedley and said, "Nah, I'm not taking him on," and went back to wherever she lives. Some of you may remember her city coming back all the way here just to watch Dr. Wedley, because the state thought that they were going to call her and she was going to show Dr. Wedley up. Didn't happen, did it? So he told you that the bruising was not obscured, and he showed you how and showed you why. Mr. Ortiz, we already talked about him a little bit, but this is something I want to say that's important. Because just like the handwriting expert that the state hired that said, I don't see anything here, just like the medical investigator, their own Dr. McFeely, who I asked, do you see anything about this that's inconsistent with a suicide? Nope. Do you see anything about this that makes it a homicide? Nope. In other words, can't tell one way or another. So their pathologist can't tell. Their crime scene analyst, Ortiz, can't tell. Their handwriting expert can tell, and it's Tara's writing on the suicide notes. But Ortiz also said something very important. So anyway, the state gave him seven suspicious things, suspicious things to look at and ask whether you can come to an opinion as to whether this was a suicide or a homicide. And he found basically none of the things suspicious except if there's a smoking gun, it's the unseated, and we all know it wasn't unseated because it was Aaron Jones talking. And even if, under some small chance, that it was unseated when the police found it, Mr. McCann first was, our expert, Mr. McCann was charged with the duty. First he was asked, can this gun shoot upside down? Because Dr. Whetley and others had come to the opinion that the gun was fired in an upside down position. So we hire the crime scene analyst, he goes out there, he makes a video, and yeah, it shoots upside down. This all happens before the 2 years had passed, and now Aaron Jones says it was unseated. Then he tries to say, okay, then we get it and say, okay, if for some reason, well, for, do you think it was seated or don't you? So he looks at all of the photographs and everything. He goes and he consults with a Glock expert who gives him back a sworn affidavit opinion. That gun is seated in all of the photographs. Then I ask him to do, and we, I'm not the only lawyer, the lawyer that was in the civil case, I didn't represent Levi in the civil case, give him an assignment and say, okay, but you know, now the state, the new theory is saying that the gun was unseated. Is it possible that the gun, that can happen? That you can find a gun lying there next to a dead person with an unseated magazine and a round in the chamber? So Whetley, I mean, McCann, all he was trying to do was determine whether such a thing could happen. And guess what? He determined such a thing could happen. That's all. Just determined it could happen. He told you, and he got up there and he said, I believe, you know, if it was unseated, this is how it happened. But he told you his preliminary opinion was that it was seated. I think we got lots and lots and lots of doubt about this case. Anyway, he said that the position of the remote control, like the DA showing you in their thing, that, well, maybe it could have been in her hand. I hope he took notes. He didn't say it was in her hand and it slid out and that's what the fingers are. He said maybe. He also said something interesting. He said that he taught Levi. He taught Levi when Levi was a law enforcement student. He taught him a course about basic forensic stuff that any beat cop learns. And he said, interestingly, that one of the things he showed him in his teachings was an intraoral gunshot wound. And Art Ortiz said that, I said, with that intraoral gunshot wound, was that one of those big explosive messes where blood and brains and everything just goes spewing out like a geyser? And he goes, yeah, it was. And then we talked to some more about Art Ortiz, and I said, yeah, and basically the gist of it was, is sometimes you get this big explosive mess, and sometimes you don't. Sometimes it comes flowing down like it did in Tara's case. Sometimes it doesn't even, you know, come out this way. It goes out an exit wound, if there's an exit wound or something. So, Levi, in addition to all of his other superhuman talents, also has to be clairvoyant because he has to know when he pulls that trigger that it will not make a big explosive mess. You know? He supposedly killed her. How's he going to know if Levi's killing her whether this is going to be the one that goes plow over you like he learned from Art Ortiz in the class, or whether it's not? Doesn't make sense. I now want to talk about Mr. Berman. Mr. Berman is one of the tops in the nation. And he told you that to a reasonable degree of scientific certainty, Tara's death was absolutely consistent with a suicide. And he showed you some of her stuff, and he talked about all of this stuff. Remember when, in her diaries, "I depend on him for life itself. I feel broken. Levi makes me feel whole." You see, she expressed herself in her writings. Her friends, her very closest friends, said she kept things bottled up. "I am almost nothing. I am the dirt on the bottom of a shoe. I feel like a huge nothing. Sometimes I just want to close my eyes and vanish. I feel worthless. Please just let me fall off the face of the earth. Please let my life start soon or let me disappear. Sometimes I feel like totally disappearing off the face of the earth. Freedom from all the stresses. I'm depressed! Exclamation point. I want to fall off the face of the earth. Marriage is a roller coaster. Levi didn't come home last night. My husband is going to leave me all alone one of these days. I am trapped. I want to leave. Love is killing me. I love him more than myself. I keep hoping his love will kill me. My heart will stop or I will disappear. I have a constant knot in my stomach. I cry all the time. The pain is one I suffer alone. And when he hurts me again, I just hope it will kill me, because emotionally I will not survive. I hate myself and so does he. Please let me disappear, fall off the earth. Myself is somehow his. He is in my blood. I can't live like this anymore. I am so sad, confused. I feel like he hates me. Why are you treating me like dirt? I give you 110% and you just hate me. Fuck you. I hate you. I fucking hate you. Why don't you love me? I give you everything. You take me for granted. I love you with all of my heart and I don't want to be without you. Please don't leave me. I'm so sad. Why are you hurting me? I'm tired of being treated like dirt. I'm so sad I want to die. I can't survive this." These are the texts she sends it. Now, Dr. Berman concludes that she was depressed, that she had little self-esteem, that she was trapped and enmeshed in a turbulent, conflictual relationship with Levi from which she could not extricate herself, being trapped and without hope are risk factors, marital strain is a risk factor, low self-esteem and high self-hate are risk factors, intolerable aloneness is a risk factor, insomnia is a risk factor, history of family suicide is a risk factor. Remember Aaron Cordova, families, three people on her, his mom's side. I'm not going to go through much of that because you heard it and you know it. Let's talk about some exhibits pretty quick because I only have a few minutes. Don't have my razzle dazzle. I want you to write these exhibit numbers down if it interests you, because I'm going to tell you some stuff that shows that the state doesn't have a case. First of all, exhibit number 150, the "I'm sorry, Levi," state tries to tell you is not a suicide note. Exhibit number 150, written by Tera Chavez, says, "I'm so sorry. All I wanted was your love. I'm sorry I wasn't good enough for you. I hope you'll be happy now." That's passive. That's what Dr. Berman talked about punishing someone, committing suicide in order to punish someone. "I hope you'll be happy now. I always loved all of you so much. That's part of what the state's leaving out. All of you. This was a goodbye note to everyone she loved. It was a suicide note because it was goodbye to not just somebody she was divorcing, Levi Chavez, but to everyone she loved. She ends it. I always loved you, all of you, so much. Goodbye to everyone that loves her. Okay, now. Levi turned his time off numerous times for extended periods of time. And you need to look at State's Exhibit Number 143, which are the Levi cell tower records. You will see that between October 3rd and October 4th, he turned his phone off over that span over 2 days for a total of 17 hours, much longer than he did in this case, in the same month, October of 07. October 3rd, 17 hours. October 9th, 7 hours. October 19th, 12.5 hours. October 20th, 5 hours. This is the day before. And then October 21st, 15 hours. And the state says to you that there's this big, huge gap, a gap of time between midnight when Levi, actually between about 12:30 when Levi gets to Deborah's home, because he goes straight there and the cell phone towers show him, remember Jody Citizen, pinging, pinging, pinging all the way from the APD West Side to Deborah's house. And when he gets there, because of what he's experienced the night before and what he's been experiencing for this long, long time, and he wants a divorce and he wants to, you know, maybe start a relationship, a deeper one with Deborah, he turns his phone off. And there's not a gap until 3 p.m. There's a gap until he wakes up in the morning and he goes off with Deborah. And Deborah told you she was with him. And Jones told you that Levi came in and showed all of his credit card bills, showing where he was the whole time. Now, Levi has the phone off, but he's with Deborah Romero. So what does he have? He doesn't have the phone off so he can go do criminal activities. He's got the phone off, but he's got, you know, he's with Deborah Romero. Okay. So, on the other hand, Nick Wheeler, not only is he talking to Tera, and I want you to look at State's Exhibit 144 and State's Exhibit 217, because you're going to see that Nick Wheeler was talking to Tera by phone once or twice daily during the week prior to her death, but he's also the last person that spoke with her. He spoke with her at 5:10 p.m. on the 20th, and at 5:13, and at 5:22. And this phone call that Russell Perea had with Levi that's supposed to be suspicious that happened on the 19th, look at States 143. It's a 31-second phone call that happens on October 19th. Levi calls, and then Russell calls him back, and they're both pinging from the same cell tower. Look at States 143. That means both of them are in the same place. Well, they could be, you know, a few feet apart. They could even be, you know, a mile or whatever apart. But he never left the west side. And Tara's last call other than to Levi was to Levi's mother, Rita. And that was one of those star 6-7. She crank called people she was worried and fearful that Levi was having an affair with, and she couldn't get a hold of Levi and couldn't get a hold of Levi. And in State's Exhibit 144, you're going to see that on October 21st at 12:59, she calls Rita's house and doesn't say a word. Remember, Rita didn't talk to her, just like Heather didn't talk to her, because that's what Tara would do. She'd call and then listen to see if she heard Levi. And in the ultimate leading up to the crescendo of the pain of Tera Chavez, she's thinking, okay, maybe he's at his mom's house, calls there. He's not there. Now she knows he's with another woman. And by the way, Levi not keeping the texts, I want you to look at State's Exhibit 144. Because on that, you're going to see that on the 20th after midnight, guess what? One of the FBI's extraction things came up with more texts. Uh-oh, Aaron Jones not telling the truth again. Remember, he tries to make it look like Levi only kept one and pretends like he had all these other texts. Okay, so here's one from Tara on October 20th, 07, after midnight. Okay, so you're obviously driving me up the wall. Anything we do will get harder before it gets easier. I just can't give up on you. I won't walk away. You are unbelievably important to you. I've given you so much. Bad times, too. I know. You are my true love. No matter what happens, I land back up with you. We are family, and I want to make it work. No matter how hard it gets, I won't give up on you. One day it'll hit you. Very little matters in life, but family, don't let me go. And the next night after midnight at 106, one by itself, I'm so sad. And then 129, I'm afraid I'm going to hurt myself. I'm so upset, sad, and hurt. That's the one Levi's saved. But, you know, less than 20 minutes earlier, she had sent one with I'm so sad. And she's lying there with her feet folded over. By the way, isn't that ridiculous that the state wants to tell you that because Levi said that when she's asleep, her feet are folded over like a little bird, and it was endearing to Levi, and he even you could sense his love for Tara right there when he talked about she folded her feet like a little bird because she had this mild case that gave her only symptoms pigeon toe, so she was pigeon toed. So when she lay down horizontally, whenever she lay down, the most comfortable position for a pigeon-toed Tara was laying down like that. That's lying down. That's when you're horizontal. There is no biological mechanism that makes your feet go from straight, if you're pigeon-toed, to go boop the second you reach unconsciousness. It doesn't work that way. State wants to say that proves she was asleep because she was like this. Crazy. There's no biological mechanism. Then you go one, two, okay, now I'm asleep. Boop. No. Whenever you're lying down and you've got pigeon toes, whenever you're horizontal, this is the most comfortable position for you, asleep or awake. Okay, I'm almost done. I want to get to I'm having to pick and choose what I'm going to show you guys. Oh, about the crank calls. In States Exhibit 144 and States Exhibit 145, you're going to find that those phone bills that were stuffed under the mattress, those have the phone numbers. Those are the same phone numbers that were crank called, that were star 67. I shouldn't call it crank call. A blocked call. She made a blocked calls in a 15-minute time period to 9 different numbers that she didn't recognize that she thought might be people Levi was seeing, and those are all matched up. I give you the two exhibit numbers. One of them shows the series of blocked calls, 9 of them in 15 minutes. The other one shows that every one of those numbers that was star 67 were numbers on the phone bill that was under her mattress because she was getting more and more and more built up and she couldn't hardly handle it anymore. Oh. Two last things I want to tell you. Okay. Let's talk about Levi. He's either a brilliant criminal who pulled off a very complicated murder and thought of everything, just about everything. A brilliant actor, a brilliant criminal who fooled experienced crime scene technicians, who fooled investigators, who fooled medical examiners, examiners, or it's a simple suicide. Let's look again at Tera and her last moments leading to her ultimate despair. Last 2 days of her life, 307 phone calls to Levi Chavez. 12:59 a.m., tries calling Rita, *67, no answer because he's with another woman. No answer again. Two more cell calls to Levi, still nothing. 1:06 a.m., texts Levi, I'm so sad, no response. Two more calls to his cell, still off. 1:29, one more hurt text to Levi, I'm afraid I'm going to hurt myself, I'm so upset, sad, and hurt. 1:30 a.m., the last call from her cell. She walks over to the armoire. She plugs her phone in because all the other outlets are being used. She grabs the gun. She walks back to the bed. She makes three more phone calls to Levi, this time from the home phone. No response. 1:45 a.m., she makes her last call to Levi. She's lying in that bed, resigned, resignation. That's what you see, not a cozy, comfortable girl asleep, but a woman who is resigned to her death because the night before she had written to Levi, one day it'll hit you. Very little matters in life but family. Don't let me go! Exclamation point. The next day, the 21st, when she died, she was convinced that Levi had let her go. And she showed him that she meant business. Levi came home, and that was the one day that it hit him that very little in life mattered but family. And what she did succeeded. Because Levi was a torn, broken man. Levi felt that God was telling him that it was all his fault. She showed him. And Levi, you don't think that that was a life-changing experience for Levi? Let me tell you, all this time I've been Levi's lawyer. We're told that Levi killed Tera for money or insurance, and whoops, he always had the insurance. That because he stole the truck, whoops, that didn't work. Because of Heather, no. Because of Regina a year before. Because of Wheeler, no. Wheeler didn't even know. Levi didn't even know that Wheeler was having an affair. Samantha Wheeler offered Tera to take Tera to get antidepressants, and Tera wouldn't go. And so now, I'm a little nervous because I'm gonna be turning over what I've been holding in my hand, Levi's case, and I'm gonna turn it over to you. And Levi called you his jury, and you are his jury. You're the jury that is gonna decide whether you are so convinced that he is guilty of murder that you are willing to condemn him and have him go down for murder one for the mother of his children, that you are beyond a strong belief, that there is absolutely zero doubt that somehow you don't hear, you don't see anything about suicide going on here, anything about depression, anything about how she could have done it herself, anything about her DNA on the grip when the swab showed no Tera blood. I'm gonna turn it over into your hands. You're the ones that are going to decide this case. We picked you because we know you're a good jury. We want you to go through as much of this as you want. We want you to use your reason and use your common sense. I'm also a little bit nervous because when I sit down, the state gets another chance. They get another bite at the apple. That's the way it should be, and that's the way it is. And so I'm not going to be up here anymore. The DA is going to be talking to you again. And the DA is going to be, you know, they, what they do is they save their best lines for rebuttal. That's where they give you their zingers because they know Serna can't get back up again. And I don't want you to forget the evidence in this case. And I don't want you to forget my summation. And I'm hoping that our confidence that we have in you will last beyond the time I sit down, through the prosecutor's rebuttal, beyond the time you go into the jury room, and that when Levi Chavez walked in here an innocent man, you are going to say that he can walk out of here an innocent man. Thank you.